more on this changing of their course of history. Down to Jessica.
Well, thank you, Mark. When you think about Vanderbilt and their success, specifically their defense, defensive coordinator Bob Shoup told me the reason they had that success is not so much that they are playing well, but they are playing winning football. He said nowadays you can give up 450 yards and still win. But for them, they focus on red zone and third down defense. He even laughed and told me before the game, hey, it's not going to be pretty stats-wise, but I'll tell you what, we can give up the run. We just cannot give up the big plays over our head with Tyler Bray.
All right, Jessica, Tyler Bray going to try and get untracked early for head coach Derek Dooley. Here's what's at stake for the Volunteers. Winless in the SEC, they've never finished winless in the conference and still in search of their first victory this year in the SEC. Meanwhile, for the Commodores, looking for their first five-game winning streak among those two numbers since 1982. We are underway. Vandy won the toss, electing to receive. Andre Hall. And he fumbles it. And the Commodores recover it out at the 23-yard line. That was number 13, Jake Seelan. There's one more look at the fumble. Seelan right there to pounce on that loose ball after Hal fumbled it. And it will be first down and 10 for quarterback Jordan Rogers. Completing 59% of his passes on the season. Nine touchdown tosses versus just three interceptions. Went through a little bit of adversity early in this season. There was a hotly contested positional challenge from Austin Carter Samuels. But Rogers establishing himself as the starter. First and 10. They set up a screen nicely. And well executed, Zach Stacy. Down to the six. Two yards on the opening play.
It's been the Achilles heel all season long for this Tennessee defense. They're in the predicament they are because this side of the ball has been problematic. And once again, there is nobody to fill. An excellent call to come out of the gate. You're anticipating a lot of emotion. You run a screen. But it's just been a killer this season. Another 20-plus play. And what a way to start for the senior in Vanderbilt.
A huge chunk on the opening play of the ballgame. Backsliding up out of the eye. Stacy gets the carry. And this time, nowhere to go. Brought down right near the line of scrimmage. Might have lost a yard at the six. Tackled by A.J. Johnson out of Gainesville, Georgia. Second down and goal. What does an opening play like that do for you psychologically?
Oh, for a quarterback, it gives you about 70 passing yards, and you feel great. And it also reassures you that this defense that's been problematic all season long, well, you're putting that thought right in their head on the road in your place exactly the way you want to start.
It'll be second down and goal for Vanderbilt. Stacy on the toss. Cuts it back up and brought down at about the 1 yard line. It'll be third down and goal. A.J. Johnson again with the tackle on the play. Are we looking at four down territory if they get stopped here on third?
I don't think so. It obviously depends on how this play and what the outcome is. But this is an area of the field that will be critical tonight. You heard Jess talk about from the defensive perspective, but offensively, James Franklin knows you can't settle for field goals against this explosive offense on the other side. Got to find a way to get touchdowns.
They line up out of the eye. Go quickly. Stacy, he won't get in. It'll be fourth down and decision time for head coach James Franklin against their rival here, Tennessee.
I think you've got to get points. You got to pay off that series. I think this is the right call. And it's also been a problematic area for you this season. And James Franklin knows it. Just 44% converting touchdowns. You get stuffed back-to-back plays. The worst thing is to not pay off that very good, momentous play to begin the game.
Well, you talk about potential buzzkill here, not being able to punch it in the end zone as Kerry Spear comes in to attempt the field goal. Looks like an extra point. They're hoping it would have been an extra point. This one from 18 yards out. He's 15 of 18 on the season. And if you're just joining us, folks, Vanderbilt took the opening play of the game, 72 yards, but end up with just a field goal. But on senior day, James Franklin, their head coach, will take it anyway. To Nashville, Mark Jones along with Brock Heward and Jessica Mendoza down to the field. You look at the Vanderbilt sideline, a pretty good beginning for them as they use five plays, 76 yards, and score on the game's opening drive. Just a field goal, though. They were hoping for a touchdown after that big first play by Zach Stacy. The Tennessee defense proving to be porous once again on the opening drive. That's the bad news for the Vols. They give up 37 points a game. The good news is that their offense scores as much per game. From the nine, Marlon Lane. And Lane brought down at about the 25-yard line. That's where their quarterback, Tyler Bray, will take over from Kingsburg, California. He's completing 69% of his passes. 29 touchdowns on the year versus just 10 interceptions. A real quote-unquote gunslinger in the classic sense, a quarterback.
And playing his best ball of his career right now. His last 3 weeks, he's been on fire, limiting those turnovers and making the big plays down the field.
Lane behind him in the backfield. Gray hands it off to Lane. And a nice burst up the middle, up to the 30-yard line. Jessica, Bray has a live arm. What about the speed on the ball?
Well, that's what's really cool. You guys are familiar with radar guns with baseball and softball, measuring the pitching speed. Well, we want to see one of the strongest arms in college football in Tyler Bray to see how strong it is.
All right, Jessica, you got that machine, and Tennessee could use a little help on that play. Sack back at the 24-yard line on the handoff. Yeah, we're going to be tracking the speed of Tyler Bray's passes throughout the course of the evening. And earlier today in warm-up, he was up to about 55 miles per hour. See how much he slings it here on a third and passing situation. Well, he throws it into the turf, and I'm not sure how fast that was. Flag down.
Before the play, false start on the offense. Number 71, 5-yard penalty, third down.
That's against Dallas Thomas.
Watch Vanderbilt tonight. James Franklin's an aggressive guy. He's got an aggressive defensive coordinator in Bob Shoup. I fully expect them to go after Tyler Bray, to not let that howitzer get warmed up and get settled in. Look for a lot of pressure in these passing situations throughout the evening.
On third and 14, Bray, a little screen pass. Took a little something off that pass and a completion and a first down to Lane and then some, right out of bounds at the 44-yard line. And a good play call, but there's a flag down back at the 28-yard line. So hold on a minute. A 25-yard gain if it stands. Here's the call.
Holding on the offense, number 84. That's a 10-yard penalty. Repeat third down.
Foul is against that guy, Cordero Patterson, the leading receiver for the Volunteers. Well, we want to welcome you if you've been watching Clemson and North Carolina State. Welcome to Nashville, where it's Tennessee against Vanderbilt. Commodores leading 3-0. They scored on their opening drive on a field goal. Here's Tyler Bray passing downfield, incomplete for Tennessee on their opening drive, intended for Justin Hunter. Here's how we got to this point on the opening play of the game after the Commodores took the opening kickoff. A screen pass to Zach Stacy, some 72 yards all the way down to the 5-yard line, but unable to punch it in. And that's where Kerry Spear kicked the 18-yard field goal to make it 3-0. And now Jonathan Krause back to get this punt from Mike Pilardi. A left-footed punter gets off a high spiral. He's down at the 40-yard line, returnable by Krause. And Krause pushed out of bounds at the 46-yard line by A.J. Johnson. So a flag down on the play, but depending on the flag, Vanderbilt will have a pretty good starting field position here. That's going to go against Tennessee. Well, we talked about the speed and the jugs machine, the radar gun that Jessica has.
On the kicking team,
that's
number 51.
Like in pregame warm-up, Tyler Bray humming it some 55 miles per hour. Now, to put that in perspective, my partner Brock Heward yesterday was slinging it a little bit, folks. He can still spin it. Don't let his humility and the fact that he's real humble fool you. He had it up to about 51, right, Brian?
We will add some context throughout this night because Tyler Bray, in my opinion, has one of the strongest arms in college football. And that's what this is really about with the radar gun out tonight. And you know, Jordan Rogers, I had the gun on him in pregame, and he's mid-40s to upper 40s. Bray is one of the most explosive guns in the game. It's going to be fun to track him tonight because they depend on the velocity and his arm talent to win games.
First down and 10. Jordan Rogers. Of course, my partner Brock will be having shoulder surgery next week. Rogers down the middle of the field, wide open. It's ruled incomplete. Quintero took a hit, and it was jarred loose by Byron Moore. A big hit by Moore from his strong safety spot here.
And the second leading tackler, I think, does an excellent job here. These kids are now being taught to target differently, and you can see he does not go for the headgear at all. He hits him in the chest. That's completely clean. And unfortunately, Quintero unable to keep that ball all the way through possession and contact with the ground.
Rogers put it right where it had to be. It'll be second down and 10. There's Stacy between the tackles down to about the 40-yard line. A.J. Johnson making the stop. Let's take a look at tonight's impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
You already got to see Zach Stacy. He's the program's all-time leading rusher. He's more guts and toughness than he is explosiveness. Jordan Matthews, 45% of all of the team's receptions, an enormous catch radius. And Chase Garnham in the middle on the other side defensively leads this team in tackles for loss and sacks because of his instinct and because of as much pressure as the Commodores like to bring defensively.
Third down and 6. Rogers last year had 4 turnovers in this game. Trying to atone for that. He mentioned it to us yesterday in our meetings with him. Little movement up front. And the pass incomplete, dropped by Jonathan Krause. And it's fourth down in a promising drive that started in decent field position. Now fourth and 6.
They may go for this, and I don't mind this call.
Why?
You get the points on the board when you drive it down there deep because there's ample opportunity to take advantage. Well, he's going to punt it. But you even look at that last play. This Tennessee defense has such a hard time covering in zones. They're without even 2 more defenders tonight. Eric Gordon is out sick. Daniel Gray, one of their backup safeties, is also out. Didn't even make the trip. I guess the head coach is saying there will be other opportunities to attack this defense, but desirable field position missed out on.
Richard Pink with the punt. Fair catch called back at the 7-yard line by Justin Hunter. 93 yards away are the balls, and Tyler Bray in that strong arm.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Miller Lite. Grab your friends, bring your IDs. If you're 21 or over, it's Miller time. And in part by John Hancock. Talk with your financial advisor.
Welcome back, everyone, to Nashville, Tennessee. Vanderbilt leading Tennessee 3-0. Just underway here in the 106th chapter of Tennessee and Vandy. The Volunteers got a nice winning streak going here in Nashville. First down and 10. Bray hands it off. And not much room for Lane. Brought down immediately by Marshall. Got about 2 on the play. Second down coming up. Tyler Bray, a junior, has 6 300-yard passing games this season. Offense hasn't been the problem this year. It's his check down man Lane. And Lane stopped up, looking at about a 3rd and long 1 coming up. What do you like, Brock?
Well, keep an eye tonight on Bob Shoup defensively. He wants to get Tyler Bray off of his mark and especially wants that pressure up the middle when bringing his linebackers and his safeties. They want Tyler Bray to move. He's very good. He's very adept. Just 5 sacks on the season. Number 1 in college football amongst passing teams. But I expect, as I said earlier, Vanderbilt to heat this thing up. And if Tennessee can run it and establish this run, it's going to be real difficult to stop tonight.
Third and short. And out to the 20-yard line, they get the first down. That was Lane again. It's been Lane exclusively. Marshall with the tackle. And this but a first down for the Volunteers.
And this is one of the better college offensive lines I've seen this season. A lot of experience. The sophomore left tackle, Richardson, the youngest of them all. The rest of them, 2-3-year starters. And they are very good, playing at a high level, too, at the line of scrimmage.
Neal in the ball game at tailback. Bray had it tipped at the line of scrimmage. Looked like Jared Morris might have gotten a hand on it, number 97. The second down and 10. Now last year, Tyler Bray pretty much held in check, partner. They held him to less than 200 yards passing. Two touchdowns and two interceptions, though, as well. Handed off. This is Neal on a little sweep. Got the first down and then some out to the 40-yard line. So they move the chains on the nice run by Neal. Neal, the team's leading rusher coming into this one.
You take a look at the line of scrimmage here. All the big bodies I talked about earlier. Great athleticism with your offensive guards. They will pull continually, get a helmet on a helmet, push the pile.
And going fast, Neal again got about three on the play, brought down by Dixon and Garnum.
90 plays. That's what offensive coordinator Jim Chaney's looking for tonight. This isn't Oregon breakneck speed, but they don't huddle. They like to get the defense on their heels, and they like to create one-on-one shots outside.
Marlon Lane back in the ballgame at tailback behind Bray. Bray wide open in the middle of the field, incomplete at the 40-yard line intended for Howard Alton. Pardon me, Alton Howard.
Just call him Pig. That's what the teammates all call him. That is his nickname, and Pig's got to bring that one in. That's a rocket shot into zone coverage. There you see some of the RPMs that Bray can create as he spins it. But that's a play you got to move to get into Vanderbilt territory.
Third and seven. Little pressure coming. Bray gets it off in time and finds his trusty receiver, Patterson. Cordero Patterson, the junior college transfer who was at this game last year when they played it in Knoxville.
And this guy is one of the freakier athletes in college football, and you love the ability to go use his hands. 6'3", 205. They want to get him 15 touches a game.
Bray had that one tipped and knocked down near the line of scrimmage. Back to Patterson. I started saying that he was at the game last year between Vanderbilt and Tennessee. He was making his official visit. And he watched the game from the sidelines. He said the great atmosphere of this game was one of the things that swayed him to choose Tennessee.
Second in receptions, one of the best kickoff return guys in college football. Getting better at receiver. Still got a long ways to go as a technician out there and running his routes. The dynamic in his athleticism.
Bray up top. Got a man. Incomplete. Intended for Justin Hunter. They got some big receivers on the outside there, partner, with Patterson, who we saw a moment ago, Hunter at 6'4", Patterson 6'3".
That ball gets away just a little bit. That is close, but you'd like to when you have your receiver that has stacked the defensive back. He's on top of him. Just keep that ball in bounds, and Bray's got another touchdown. Would have been his 30th of the season.
Well, that's going to be a nice matchup to keep an eye on, right, with Trey Wilson. Got a bunch of touchdowns off of interceptions, and Justin Hunter.
Free play.
There's a screen. They set it up well. Lane puts his hat down and is stopped up about 2 yards short of the first down. But there's a flag down on the play, and looks like it's going to be offside against the Commodores.
Offside on the defense. Jumping in the neutral zone. That's a 5-yard penalty. Third down.
One of the challenges that James Franklin and his defensive coordinator Bob Shoup have tonight, and it's a balancing act, and it's delicate, because I don't think they're good enough just to rush four against this group and this offensive line. Let me remind you, Tyler Bray has been sacked just 5 times this entire season. He gets rid of the ball. So to get pressure on him, to affect him, you have got to bring it. But when you bring it, well, then you leave those corners, as you mentioned, outside in critical one-on-ones.
Here comes a blitz. And Bray got it off in time, but incomplete intended for Patterson. Are you looking at four down territory for the orange here? Or
what's the strength of your team?
Offense.
That's exactly right.
37 points a game.
Tyler Bray trying to anticipate. He's thinking he's going to get that call. Lots of contact there between Andre Howell and Patterson. No flag.
Right around 50% on the season. 8 of 15 on fourth down conversion. Plenty of time. Incomplete, intended for Hunter. And the Commodore defense led that time by Trey Wilson on the pass breakup. There he is. They win the first critical battle on the first fourth down gamble.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
Look at downtown Nashville, Tennessee. Music City, USA, West End Avenue, some of the sights. Great city to get out and enjoy some of the different types of music here. And right now, it's Vandy that's the band leader.
And a great city to recruit to, as James Franklin told us about a half dozen times yesterday.
Had a bunch of high-profile recruits at this game. This is Tate in the ball game. And Tate gains a maybe a yard on the play, and you mentioned and alluded to the fact that this is a great city to recruit to. Vanderbilt with a wonderful academic reputation, and there's an interesting group of players that Coach Franklin has really targeted and trying to build his success around. Off to a pretty good start in his first 2 years, a whistle and a flag down on the far side of the field.
Before the play, encroachment on the offense, lined up in the neutral zone, number 87. That's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
You know, Coach Franklin told us that his recruiting classes are continuing to improve. In fact, it's ranked number 15, the 15th best. In a situation where he says our kids have multiple other SEC offers, that really underscores the quality of players they're starting to attract.
Well, that's how you're winning. That's how they're able to accomplish this. Recruiting is the lifeblood for any program, and that top 15 class right now, Mark, has 9 four-star recruits that are verbally committed. That is unheard of. Unheard of here in Nashville with this program.
Second and 14. There's a fumble, and then Zach Stacy runs it and gains about 2 yards. Jessica has more.
Well, Mark, you talk about what they sell to recruits. The 5 big points that James Franklin, when he goes in the house, is academics, the SEC, the fact you can play early in your career, the big city, which you guys mentioned. But lastly, you go to another school, you rent a legacy. Here at Vanderbilt, you can own it.
Own it, build it, get your own equity in it. Stopped at the 36-yard line was Jordan Matthews, the team's leading receiver, by Justin Coleman. Got about 4 on the play.
Well, right now, James Franklin's not thinking about recruiting. He's thinking about getting his team here to just execute the little details. You're fumbling snaps, you're dropping third downs. He knows it. You hit that screen pass, you get inside the 5-yard line. Ample opportunity in this first quarter to separate yourself from an explosive offense and not doing the little things, executing the attention to detail. And that's frustrating the head coach.
Great pump by Richard Kent. Back to the 18-yard line. Patterson still on his feet. He's got a lane down the sidelines. Boy, you see why offensive coordinator Jim Chaney says he might be the most dynamic, unique player he's ever seen, ever had, after he gets the ball in his hands.
Mark, we're on the playground tonight, and every player out here in pads, and I get first pick, that's my guy. That's my guy. Is he polished? Is he precise? No. Is the guy out on the playground running over, running through, jumping over people? Yes. And a difference maker, while he was one of the top JUCO recruits a season ago.
Hutchinson, JC. First down and 10 for the Vols. They run it with Lane. And Lane stopped down at about the 48-yard line. Got about 2 on the play. They've had some issues at the tailback spot, trying to get some consistency. Neal was injured.
injured at his ankle 5 weeks ago. And when healthy, he's one of the fastest players on this Tennessee team, which is really saying a lot.
Bray under heat, and they sack him back at the 37. Asubake got there. His fourth of the season.
Speaking of recruiting and four-star recruits, well, Caleb was one of the top DNs a season ago, had SEC offers galore. Offshoot told us yesterday, hit a little bit of a freshman wall, but in a rivalry game, trying to get after Tyler Bray and that big arm and that talent they have offensively, you see the freshman showing up big.
Third and 17. Underneath again, nice move by Lane. Battles out near midfield, but stopped up short of the first down by about 6 yards.
Well, Vanderbilt is playing some winning defense and not just doing it statistically. And Bob Shoup has got to be just tickled up in the booth through the first three possessions here. Getting after Tyler Bray, staying in those third and long situations. James Franklin animated about what he's seeing on the field.
Already been a real successful year for them. They're bowl eligible for back-to-back seasons for the first time in school history. Fourth and 7. Girardi just airmails this one. And he gets a fantastic fortuitous bounce. He stuck it at the 1 yard line. Mike Velarde getting it done, 50 yards on the punt. Well, tonight at 8, it's the perfect opportunity to use Watch ESPN. You can check out number one Kansas State versus Baylor on ESPN with your laptop, tablet, or mobile device using WatchESPN.com or the Watch ESPN app while enjoying the battle between number one, actually 13, Stanford, and number two, Oregon on ABC. Tell you what, I wear mine out on the iPhone. Look at the size of my man in the middle there.
That's 6'8",
380.
And you better move him here at the 1 foot line.
Backed up in the shadows of the goal line. There he is. Good three-step drop and the pass complete. And boy, you talk about getting some priceless breathing room. Jordan Matthews working against Prentice Wagner. Picks up the first down.
That's a good thing they didn't run. You saw the push there by McCullers, and Jordan Matthews has 45% of the reception, 71 now on the season, and quite a connection between the senior Rogers and his go-to receiver outside. And McCullers is as big a guy as there is in college football. They said he came in at 400 pounds. He's down, Mark. He's down about 375.
Zach Stacy with a couple of nice moves. Flag down on the play, but Stacy got about 9 if it stands.
Holding on the offense, number 38, half the distance to the goal. Repeat second down.
That's against Fitz Lassing, the fullback, comes out of the ball game. Zach Stacy, leading returning rusher in the SEC this year.
Vanderbilt uses a lot of multiple personnel groups. They'll get and use the fullback, and you can't hook them, especially not in clean view of the umpire.
Pushes the ball back to the 5.5 yard line. And since that first play, it's been tough sledding for the Commodores. First and 15 for quarterback Jordan Rogers. Overthrows his intended target, Josh Grady. Second down and 15 coming up.
And Vanderbilt's not good enough right now to have holding calls, to have fumbled snaps, to have drop passes. They need to be clicking. And Jordan Rogers knows it. He's been playing at a high level. Just one interception his last 5 games. Told us yesterday, I stopped pressing. Started to believe and trust the system and everyone around me. Got to sharpen up the little fundamentals right now that are getting them in this first quarter.
Second and 15. Run it and find some success out to the 18-yard line. Zach Stacy again, so it'll be third down and short after the gain of 12. What do you like here coming up, Rob?
Well, now you put yourself in a very manageable situation. I like attacking the zone coverage of Tennessee with all of their injuries and the challenges they have, and a true freshman number 33 playing safety. You've seen Sal Cenceri try to protect his guys and play a lot of zone coverage. And Rogers should be good enough, advanced enough here as a fifth-year senior to beat that zone.
Zach Stacy with the direct snap, and he won't get enough for the first down. They tried a little wildcat, but not quite enough yardage. And it's fourth and short coming up for Vanderbilt.
That's our boy A.J. Johnson, leading tackler, fifth in America. This defense has struggled, but he's been the guy that's made them go, explosive plays. And that will be something to watch tonight. The interior of this defensive line for Tennessee, which is big, like Georgia that got after Vanderbilt earlier this season. There is some size and strength in the front seven. And for Tennessee, the better defensive quarters of the season.
Kent with the punt. Patterson calls for the fair catch at the 30-yard line. It'll be first down and 10. This is the 106th edition of Tennessee against Vanderbilt. Mark Jones, Brock Huer, Jessica Mendoza down in the field. Your thoughts so far on a rivalry that is a little bit more spicy under the surface when you consider some of the comments that were made inside that Volunteer locker room
In
the wake of their victory last year in Knoxville.
And a rivalry that's just been dominated by the Orange. I mean, 28 of the last 29, and Vanderbilt's got this big chip on their shoulder. In fact, some of the kids yesterday walking around their facility have that T-shirt with the word chip written right on it, and they know the importance of this one tonight. And the only way to get that respect is to earn it.
Well, Patterson is exciting. You really get the sense that people hold their breath when he touches the ball on both teams. A late flag after the 14-yard gallop. Cordell Patterson.
Personal foul, late hit out of bounds on the defense, number 28. That's a 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
That's a converted safety now playing weak side linebacker, Carl Butler. And I think, unfortunately for him, he's just along for the ride. Typically, when that contact occurs on the playing field, they give you the opportunity to ride him out. That's a tough call for Vanderbilt.
A half minute to go now in the first quarter. Neal in the ball game. Got about a yard on the play. Take one more look at that personal foul.
So he makes contact there. And he's in bounds.
Yeah. Huh. Second and 10.
Watch for the shot.
Gray couldn't fit it in between the defensive back and the safety intended for Justin Hunter.
That's a couple now. That's about three throws in this first quarter. And you see Tyler Bray a little bit fired up. He's an excitable guy. This is an emotional game. This is one they have to have in Vanderbilt's venue. And he's got to slow his arm down, slow his game down a bit.
They like to pressure a lot defensively. Blitz. Is that what's got him a little bit off right now?
Well, I think it's the energy of this moment as well.
Oh, what a hit. Incomplete. It was intended, the guy affectionately called Pig by his teammates, Howard, and he got drilled by Trey Wilson.
Once again, Tyler has got to see that zone coverage. I think you're right. There's a good mix of looks, and you see the conversation. But you got to see that corner sitting there squatting. He's ready to unload on your receiver.
You talk about a great way for the Commodores to punctuate a lead at the end of the first quarter in this rivalry game. That would be it. Welcome back to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Miller Lite. It's the SEC on ESPN in a low-scoring first quarter. 3-0, the Vanderbilt Commodores leading the Tennessee Volunteers. Mark Jones alongside Brock Huard. Jessica Mendoza's down on the field. Fourth down coming up.
Had a great punt earlier, able to place it on the 1-yard line. This time places it inside the 10.
Let's go back to that pivotal third down a few moments ago.
Well, Vanderbilt had me fooled as well in the booth as they did Tyler Bray. I thought that this was zone coverage, that Trey Wilson had just that cloud, but he didn't. He is in man coverage, and watch his eyes. They never go off the quarterback, and he jumps that route. I will tell you what's coming down the road, the conversation that Tyler's having right now with coordinator Jim Chaney in the booth, and that is, hey, listen, they are reading your eyes. They are jumping routes. You have to manipulate this defense, even man coverage, and there'll be some home runs to hit later.
Rodgers hands it off to Stacy. Stacy squared those shoulders a little bit, got up to about the 12-and-a-half-yard line, pushed out of bounds by Justin Coleman. Jordan Rodgers mentioned some of the adversity he faced earlier in the season. He was benched earlier in the year and supplanted a quarterback. And really kind of simplified his approach, learned that he's got to take better care of the ball and manage the game better. And has since been the starter. He was benched for the Presbyterian College game. Carlos Samuel started that game, and Rodgers back the following week against Georgia. Second and six. Casey again, back down at the 13-yard line. Hey, partner, are you surprised that it's such a low-scoring first quarter and a low-scoring game so far?
I am a little bit. I'm more surprised by Tennessee's offense not getting going, but this is going to be one of the challenges for Jordan Rodgers tonight and why he can't press. You're going up against a very physical group. I mentioned the size already of McCullers, but this Tennessee defense, if there is a strength, it's going to be their front seven. And one of Vanderbilt's weaknesses as they're growing this program is still the point of attack. They're undersized. They've reshuffled that offensive line. And right now, they're getting very little movement at the line.
Third and six. Hand it off and nowhere to go. A smattering of boos here at the near sellout. Actually, it is a sellout. Over 41,000 on hand here at Vanderbilt Stadium. And that in itself tells you that the expectations
yes.
are a little bit higher than they used to be around here.
And I'm a little surprised we're not seeing the perimeter tested a little bit more. A very conservative call here. A lot of conservative calls offensively because the strength of Vanderbilt is Jordan Matthews, Chris Boyd, the bubble screens, the perimeter game. They're trying to establish and run at the belly of Tennessee. Not happening right now.
Richard Kent coming from his own three.
Watch out for Patterson.
He's playing for a fair catch at the 41-yard line. It'll be good field position to start things off for the Tennessee Volunteers. Going to see if Tyler Bray can get it up to about 55 miles per hour on that machine when we come back. Interesting right now. Kansas State playing at Baylor tonight. Trap game or not?
No.
No? Okay.
Not when Grandpa's coaching.
Okay.
Joe Snyder been around too long to have trap games. Notre Dame finally passing the eye test today as well.
Nice run up the middle. That's Lane. And Lane close to the first down as we take a look at the Tostitos BCS standings. What's the possible scenario where the SEC does not get shut out of the championship game? I mean, there's some dominoes that have to fall there, right?
But there is a lot of ball to play, and Oregon has by far the toughest road, beginning even tonight with Stanford.
Nice run again by Lane. Got about nine on the play. But right now, the SEC on the outside looking in.
Stanford, the Civil War on the road. UCLA, that's now 9-2. Kansas State, Baylor will score tonight. Texas in 2 weeks. Notre Dame's got to travel all the way across the country. No sure thing with those top three.
Boy, Tennessee just ground and pound right now.
Well, it should
Lane
be
to, with 11 yards.
And it
in the
should
first
be
down.
To your eye test, Mark. Yeah. Just look at the difference between Vanderbilt's offensive line, who was not moving the group for Tennessee at all, versus these big fellas up front in a very veteran offensive line getting after Vandy's front.
Just a plain old simple ISO again. That was Neal. Got about three on the play. Tennessee going quick, playing at a high tempo offensively. There's a look at the balance. Right around 50-50 right now.
And that's unique. This team is built on the arm of Tyler Bray. The last 3 weeks, he's averaged over 400 yards passing, but I like the patience playing to the strength of your group up front.
Looking to pass it, pressure off the edge. And nobody home, not even close. For Darryl Patterson, the nearest receiver, but
They tried to heat him up again, Brock.
Yeah, right now, Vanderbilt's crew is doing a nice job of blurring the picture for the big 6'6" signal caller out of Kingsburg, California.
That one hit 50 miles per hour.
Anything north of 50 is exceeding or at the top of NFL standards.
Third and seven. Wide open. Patterson. Room service. Touchdown. But there's a flag down on the play. Let's hold on and see if this stands. Al was left wide open. He came on the blitz. Well, Al blitzed.
And you see the hands on the hips by Derek Dooley, wondering what in the world this could be. Because there is your 6'6" junior that's seen a lot of ball. Finally read the blitz, get the picture.
Might this be a celebration penalty?
No, I think that came early. Now, that one did. That one is. You're going to see the side judge fumbling and bumbling for his flag. And, yes, they called a celebration. But before that, in the middle of the pile, a flag as well.
James Stone was downfield. So it looked like a touchdown for Tennessee. Does a 180. And they're going to spot it back at the 32-yard line after the penalty.
So you're going to see Vanderbilt bring the corner blitz here. Tyler Bray sees it, but also watch the center for Tennessee downfield. And that's a good call. That ball went past the line of scrimmage. Your center can't be 6 yards downfield.
Third and 12. Bray for Hunter. Incomplete, and a flag thrown. Stephen Clark there defending the play. They had a little bump and grind going on down the sidelines.
Well, welcome to a rivalry game, huh?
That's against Clark. Usually their third DB, the nickel guy. Take a look at that last penalty against Patterson. This was the taunting penalty.
That's exactly right. Take advantage of the corner blitz. Your center just can't be downfield. And this is the right call. I mean, you just can't get away with that. And then here's lots of grabbing and lots of contact. And I don't know about that. When that receiver, Hunter, does not make an effort back to the ball, and I didn't see enough contact there to impede him from doing so. Some iffy calls both ways here in the first 20 minutes.
First and 10. Number 17. Lane. Going to be stopped up at about the 13-yard line. Barnes leading the charge of tacklers for the Commodores. Got about three on the play.
And this is the area of the field, and Jess talked about it in the open, where Vanderbilt has really won a bunch of games. That's good stuff. In this conference, when you're number one ahead of Alabama and South Carolina in red zone defense, they are so smart, they are so sound, and as this field condenses, well, it minimizes some of their athletic struggles.
Play on the seam, touchdown, Tennessee! Zach Rogers, the native of Nashville, with a successful homecoming so far.
It's amazing what all that run does, isn't it, Mark? We see it week in and week out at any level of football, pro ball, college ball, high school. When you can run and you can attack the line of scrimmage, those linebackers have to peek in, and when they do, and you got a rocket behind it, that makes it hard to stop and contain defense, play defense.
Rodgers with his sixth touchdown catch of the season, the eighth of his career, with all his friends and family members from Nashville watching. Number 83 coming through again for the Vols. Tennessee with the lead when we come back. Folks, tensions at their peak as Brad Keselowski tries to hold off five-time champ Jimmy Johnson in the final race of the season to determine the championship and earn a spot in history. The NASCAR chase for the Sprint Cup. Ford EcoBoost 400 at Homestead, Miami, Sunday, 1:30 on ESPN. And Jeff Gordon last week got into it, folks. If you didn't see it, he was fined $100,000 after being involved in that fracas and docked 25,000 points, further adding to the intrigue of this week's race down in South Florida. Into the turn, Kimbrough flagged down at the 14-yard line.
Kimbrough on return, flags on the play.
During the return, block in the back. On the return team, number 12, half the distance to the goal. First down.
Wendy Nix, what's Kansas State up to?
Mark Jones, thank you very much. It's a Dr. Pepper conference update. Six plays, 82 yards in less than 2 minutes, and Kansas State is looking at a deficit. Nick Florence to Tevin Reese, and the Baylor Bears strike first. Todd McShay's upset special, by the way, this game on ESPN.
All right, Wendy, partner, I'm not going to jump on you early, but you did say that Grandpa isn't going to...
No trap game. Baylor is going to score some points.
All right. I'm just checking, man. First down and 10. Pass incomplete, and they can't afford any drops like that. Chris Boyd had that one go right through his hands. He's the team's second leading receiver. Brock, you look at the numbers between Matthews and Boyd, they have pretty much all of the receptions on this squad.
110 of 160, that's nearing 70%. You know where it's going. Patterson, Hunter on the other side are big athletic guys, and so are Matthews and Boyd. In fact, their production is even more so than anybody else in the SEC and this Tennessee duo. Tennessee's making it hard right now. Those little gimmies, those little hitches, those bubble screens, the Volunteers doing a nice job of taking away the strengths of Vanderbilt.
Second and 10 out of the end zone. Just got rid of it. And I didn't see a receiver in the vicinity. Maybe there was. Yeah, Stephen Shue was there. Shoy was there. Let's go back to that touchdown pass thrown by Tyler Bray a few minutes ago. You know, we saw an unsportsmanlike taunting penalty called against Patterson, but when you start judging mannerisms, you get into dangerous territory sometimes. That's the rule. Bray staring down the Vanderbilt side of the field, eyeballing them, and talked a little bit of junk, too.
You like that,
though. I can't lie. Third and 10. Down and 10. Pass tipped and almost intercepted by the Volunteers. Intended for Jordan Matthews, and it's fourth down. They'll have to punt in the shadows of their own goalposts.
And the big fella is getting it done. He's not 400 pounds. But look at the boys in the middle, and if you don't get home, put your hands up. That's a nice play by Darrington Centimore. And how about now, the fourth three and out for Vanderbilt at home against the 111th worst defense in college football.
With the punt. That's off a great one. Patterson had the chance to field it. And now he backs off.
And he's kicking himself because he knows he catches that in the air. There was a lot of space and a lot more plays for Mr. Patterson to make.
Big punt by Kent.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by 7-Up. Make any party you host refreshingly different with the crisp, clean taste of 7-Up. And Tabasco Buffalo-style hot sauce with a classic buffalo flavor.
There's a look at Jordan Rogers with head coach Franklin and some of the other 19 seniors playing their final home game here at Vanderbilt Stadium. Don't want to trivialize the night. It's a big deal, isn't it?
Oh, it sure is. Yeah, very emotional. I think, unfortunately, maybe some of those emotions getting in the way offensively is some of their execution.
Ray on first down and 10. Tennessee's still having a lot of success running that football. Another first down, Marlon Lane. And about 14 that time.
My old teammates Jay Graham, now the running backs coach, the former Volunteer running back himself, and he said to me tonight, watch out for Marlon Lane. The sophomore is getting better week to week, growing in his comfort here. And when these big fellas lock up this defensive line and move the line of scrimmage and create some space, then all advantage Volunteers.
Lane almost 60 yards rushing already. This time they make Gray move around. Tipped up and intercepted. John L. Thomas, one of those 19 seniors. And Vanderbilt will take over on the turnover.
And do they ever need this defensively? A little bit of that movement. That's what they wanted to create with the outside pressure. You see Rob Lohr get his hand up. Thomas finish on the other end. Maybe sometimes that's why it doesn't always pay to get cocky and look at that bench, because the ball can bounce funny ways in this game.
First down and 10. Hey! Maybe take a shot after the first play up top. And no one home. Rodgers incomplete. Double coverage on the play. Intended for Chris Boyd. Who's the game breaker? Who's the guy that can break it open for Vanderbilt? Do they have that piece?
That's the one element they're trying to continue to build. Brian Kimbrough, the true freshman, maybe one of the biggest recruits that James Franklin has landed here. He's got some juice. Jordan Matthews with his 70-plus receptions outside can be a difference maker. That's exactly what Vanderbilt is looking for, my friend.
Wesley Tate in the game. That's Kimbrough. That's who you were alluding to just a second ago. Run out of bounds at the 28-yard line. Nice gain. Let's go back to Wendy.
Mark, thank you. A look at what's going on around our networks. Number one, Kansas State has just scored, pending the extra point. It's 7-6 this game on ESPN, Kansas State and Baylor. And on ABC, we are scoreless, Stanford and Oregon. Mark?
All right. You know, Brock, I hope Wendy hasn't lost her stinger today, because the Wofford team losing today as the SEC went to work on some of the FCS teams. And that's her alma mater. First and 10. Nice run over the left side. Tate with another first down for the Commodores. He got 13.
It's always amazing what one first down can do. I told you earlier, 4-3 and outs. You just see those chains move, and a much better job at the point of attack, getting movement with the double team. And you got to find a way to get away from some of the big, massive humanity inside. The advantage for Vanderbilt will be some of that outside perimeter run.
Wesley Tate taking a direct snap here on the Wildcat. Tennessee screening that one out. Nowhere to go.
That's got to be a penalty. You called it the other side.
That's a good point.
You called it the other side.
That's
exactly right. Now, they called it on the other sideline. What we saw earlier, Carl Butler was riding Cordarrelle Patterson out of bounds. Likewise, there was contact on the field. James Franklin say he called it the other way. My guy Tate gets slammed to the ground, and there's no 15. That's a bad call. You got to make that call. What he wants is that he wants it called evenly. It's like in baseball, man. You call it on the other side, I can live with that. But when it happens our way, he's going to make the same call.
Franklin incensed on the sideline. Second and 11. Little blitz coming. They pick it up. Into the end zone. Flag down. Incomplete. McNeil covering on the play against Jordan Matthews. I'm not sure that pass was catchable. Oh. Ah.
I think that's exactly what the conversation is ongoing right now with the four referees.
Going to be pass interference.
Pass interference on the defense. Number 33. The ball will be placed at the 2-yard line. Automatic. First down.
And that's the true freshman, McNeil, and he's matched up on the corner route. Nice job by Vanderbilt to get their best player, Matthews, into space. And once again, I mean, we saw that call earlier. However, there's consistency at least, because we saw pass interference against Hunter, which I thought was questionable. That's questionable best as well.
First down and goal from the 2.
of controversial plays. Vanderbilt unable to score last time. They had it first and goal inside the five. And stopped up again is Wesley Tate. It'll be second down and goal. Remember, after the first play of the game, they got all the way down to the first 5-yard line. Tried it three times, unable to score. Ended up with a field goal only. Second and goal. Tossed to the wide side of the field and nowhere to go again. The Volunteer defense rising up. And somebody lost a hat down there. They'll have to come out of the game.
Well, this has been a challenge for Vanderbilt. 15 to 35 themselves scoring touchdowns. And who has to come out? Maybe one of the best players for Tennessee defensively. That's weak side linebacker Herman Lathers. But you see with the idea, get away from those big guys, try to get outside. But unfortunately, the contain and the speed on the back end of this Tennessee defense, and the linebacker in particular, has answered the call down here in the red zone. Got to be Matthews in motion.
That's him to the top of your screen. Rogers, let's go. Get incomplete. No flag on the play. Fourth and goal coming up now. Decision time. Do you go for it? Last time you kicked the field goal. How demoralizing is it
You've
if
got
you
to
don't
take
get a
points.
Touchdown?
Mark, you have got to take points in these games. Don't get greedy. You have watched your offense now, unfortunately, have six cracks at it and get nothing.
Here comes the field goal unit. So for the second consecutive time, they get inside the five, first and goal, unable to get a touchdown.
I'm going to guess if they get down there a third time, you're going to see a heavy run play pass in the early situations instead of trying to establish that run.
There's Spear, this one from 22 yards out, connected earlier from 19. 16 of 19 on the year.
This is for a school record.
For the snap, delay a game on the offense, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
That's going to be, I believe, intentional. We'll set up the angle, but Mr. Spear has tied the single season school record. This is to one up it. Very efficient this season, special teams solid for the Commodores.
You know, a Tennessee defense that has been much maligned coming into this game tonight, surrendering 37 points a game, the worst in the conference. With two big green zone, red zone. I call it green zone because that's where you get the money. Able to keep Vanderbilt out of the end zone. The 27-yard field goal good. Not what Coach Franklin wanted, though. Celebrating its 8th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. Now, to date, Allstate has contributed more than $2.9 million in scholarship monies. Jordan Rogers on the phone with his coaches trying to figure out exactly what went wrong, Brock.
And that's offensive coordinator John Donovan more than likely. And as I said, that early down run, that's on two occasions. They get down inside the 5-yard line. It's been run first down, run second down, a variety of runs. But runs nonetheless that have gotten them nothing. So when that is the challenge in the red zone, you expect that play action pass next time they're down there.
Commodores got 3 points off of that interception. The turnover. There's a look at Patterson back for this kick. And that's field goal. I want to remind you by Harry Spears. Kick it away from Patterson. Lane's going to take it out 2 yards deep to the 17-yard line as we go back to Wendy in the studio.
We're going to need this, the referees to hang with us here if we're going to pull off this upset.
Okay. All right, guys. We got you. Meanwhile, new quarterback in the ballgame, Justin Worley, number 14 right there for the Volunteers, completes a pass of 17 yards to Patterson. Gray on the sidelines. We've got Jessica Mendoza down on the sidelines. Maybe she can find out what the news is on Gray as Neal runs for about 5. Jessica on her way over there. Tyler Bray leading the team down the field for the touchdown last time they were on. Let's look at his numbers on the night. Just 6 of 17. Worley out of the backfield to the fullback, Bartholomew. First down for the Volunteers out near midfield.
And this is new. It's not as if Worley has been worked in this season. Just 12 passes through the 10 games coming in. And yeah, Bray missed a few tonight, but I don't know if this is a situation where Derek Dooley wants just him to sit out and to watch a series after that tipped interception, or if something physically is ailing.
Well, he did have that knee injury against Mississippi State, and subsequently wearing a brace, they're going to whistle this one dead, flag down on the play.
For the snap, false start. Offense, number 74, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Bray missed a few games last year due to injury, but has been relatively healthy this year. You talk about the reason why. He's added a bunch of weight since stepping on campus as a very lithe and wispy freshman.
Stood up 185, sits at 222 now. Yeah, that's a good 37 pounds.
More movement up front and another flag on the play.
This is one of the challenges when you bring in a backup quarterback. And Dooley wants that to be against Vanderbilt.
Offside on the defense, number 53. 5-yard penalty, first down.
That one against the Commodores. And that puts it back right around midfield at the 50-yard line.
Both these coaches tonight busy working the sidelines,
yeah,
aren't they?
60 yards and penalties tonight for the Commodores. On the fly sweep to no avail. Jared Morse with a big stick. Alton Howard took a big lick.
Yeah, that's a big fella not missing the mark right there, does he? He's unblocked coming through that line of scrimmage. It's tackle for loss number 9 on the season for the big fella.
Loss of 5 on the play, back to the 45. Worthy hands it off. And Neal gains back a few. Let's get an update downstairs from Jessica.
Well, Mark, Tyler Bray is not injured. It's definitely a decision coming from the coaching staff to sit him down. So definitely not an injury. It's something that they're seeing lack of with his production.
All right, Jessica. Some good information. 3rd and 14 coming up. Justin Worley in on his first series of the game. They're going to try and heat him up right here. Got rid of it and got picked. Down to the 18.
Phil, the player was down after the interception. First down, Vanderbilt.
The first turnover by Tennessee of the game now.
Now, I don't understand the benching of Ray. He wasn't sharp tonight, not at his best, but I don't know, sitting him and putting the backup quarterback in, he's not on the same page with Cordero Patterson. He's expecting Patterson to hook it up, and this is a veteran Vanderbilt defense. 4 seniors, 7 juniors. They read routes. We've already seen that tonight. They'll jump these routes and take advantage. Without an injury, I think a questionable decision to bring in a sophomore into this game, into this rivalry and moment, without much experience through this season.
How much a factor was the pressure they put on him in that play and that result?
Oh, absolutely, and that pressure has affected Tyler. There's no doubt about it. Okay, you can't apologize for the first 20 minutes for Tyler. It wasn't his best ball. He made some poor decisions, but the tipped interception to then pull him and yank him and put the sophomore in.
Looks like they came after Worley, too.
Yeah, he's clearly down. Clearly down.
Well, they're looking at that last play. The ruling on the field was that he was down.
This could be a very good wake-up call for Tyler Bray to come out to just watch the game, watch a series, slow down, because right now, through the first half of this game, that blitz has affected him. He has rushed throws and missed some throws. But to me, the guy has been unbelievably productive, as both his coaches and the Vanderbilt coaches said.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. He was down. First down, Vanderbilt.
Tyler Bray has played the best ball of his career, and you decide to sit him, put the backup in, who is very green himself, and he and Patterson not on the same page.
First down from the 17-yard line. James Franklin's Commodores looking for their seventh win of the season and their fifth conference win.
Let's just put it this way. Mr. Franklin and Bob Shoup up in the booth, the defensive coordinator, I can promise you they'd much rather see Mr. Worley than Mr. Bray.
First and 10. Jordan Rogers at the helm for the Commodores. Play pass. Come back on the receiver screen. Oh, and Matthews tried to hand walk there. Still picked up seven, but a shoestring tackle by McNeil. Pardon me, that was Boyd.
That's exactly what you're going to do. You're going to fake that toss. You've not been successful. They set that up, and that's inches away from going to the house. I like that call.
Second down and about three to go. Two previous times they've been in the red zone, unable to punch it into the end zone. Rodgers out of the shotgun. He kept it himself and didn't have anywhere to go. Third down coming up.
Yeah, that's exactly
a loss of one.
That's exactly right. That was unfortunate for Mr. Rodgers in his neighborhood, running right into the teeth of a corner blitz. That's a no-chance play.
They have been unable to push the right button in the red zone tonight. Another field goal. It's the type of thing, Brock, that could come back to sting you late in the game when you say, boy, I wish you'd have had a touchdown or two off those turnovers. Third down and four. Coach Franklin consulting that play chart of his. See which string he pulls when we come back. Folks, get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN at 10 a.m. at Sunday NFL Countdown. Host Chris Berman and the gang providing all the latest news and updates from stadiums around the league right up to kickoff. And then, before you set your lineups, catch Fantasy Football Now at 11 a.m. on ESPN2 as our experts provide the latest news and reports and predict the top fantasy performers. Third and goal.
Wish you a speedy recovery, Coach Ditka.
Two tight ends and two wideouts. Rodgers into the end zone. Caught. Touchdown. Wow. Boyd. Oh, boy. Chris Boyd with the juggling act in the back of the end zone to give Vanderbilt a 12-7 lead. They get 13-7.
A season ago, Mr. Boyd was second in the SEC with 8 touchdown receptions. Now that's his fourth on the year, and you're targeting a backup. Marsalis Teague is in this game. He hadn't played the last 5 weeks. Go after him. And what concentration. Oh. That's good in the NFL, too, my friend.
Ooh. Great awareness there, Brock. There's a top 10 nominee, Chris Boyd.
You asked earlier, who are some of the guys that can get this thing going? Who's going to step up for Vanderbilt in multiple opportunities tonight to finish on the other end? And Boyd, the redshirt sophomore, shows you that he's more than capable at 6'4", 205, to win those jump balls. Not the best throw that Jordan has thrown with the contact, getting hit on delivery. But sometimes as a quarterback, he just, and his body language says it, he knows it, not perfectly thrown, but just give your guy a chance to help you out on the other end.
Hey, this isn't the BCS for style points, okay? It's just a touchdown, right? I mean, after being in the red zone 3 times, they finally get a touchdown. Boyd, his 4th touchdown of the season.
And it was Boyd a week ago with the game-winning touchdown against Ole Miss.
That's the part of the changing culture that James Franklin has happening here. The evolution of Vanderbilt football, folks, happening right now before your eyes. Last week, a clutch conference win on the road. A comeback win at Ole Miss. Patterson from the 15. And Patterson with points on his mind. Man, he's slippery, Wendy Nix. Back to you.
Thank you, Mark. Kansas State and Baylor this time. No flag for the Bears. Nick Florence on the carry. And Baylor strikes first, and then again here, they lead 14-7 on ESPN. And over on ABC, it's Oregon and Stanford. The Ducks, 4th-and-1 here on the 7-yard line. Marcus Mariota stopped. We stay scoreless on ABC.
All right, Wendy. Justin Worley back in for his second series at quarterback. The previous one, his first, resulted in interception that set up a touchdown for Vanderbilt. Let's see if he can calm down here and make it easy on him. And it's Lane running it out near midfield. 10-yard gain. Let's go back and look at the touchdown. What was the key here?
Well, I told you it wasn't the most accurate throw from Jordan Rodgers, and that's a large reason why. You see Herman Lathers get into his legs, but Jordan does just enough and puts just enough air on that pass to allow Boyd to finish on the other end.
Always feels better when the guy at the other end makes the catch, right? And here's Lane. Lane down to the 45-yard line.
You might be real curious to hear what Derek Dooley has to say coming off this field at halftime about this quarterback change. Tyler Bray was not sharp. He was not efficient. He didn't play his best half of football. I understand all of that. But he's also the guy that's lit up your offense, the 7th best in America. And right now, he's sitting and watching the true sophomore Worley.
Approaching 2 minutes to go in the first half. Worley fires a dart complete to Hunter. And Hunter tackled at the 36-yard line. Another first down, picked up actually 9 on the play. Trey Wilson making the stop. Worley, Hunter left wide open. I mean wide open. Let's go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you. Coming up on the Outback Steakhouse Halftime Report, we'll have highlights from Kansas State and Oregon. That's 1 and 2. With one game remaining, Notre Dame remains unbeaten, and it's scrimmage Saturday throughout the SEC. We'll show you how they fare. Todd McShay and Robert Smith join me at the half.
Early hands it off this time. That's Neal. And Rajon Neal down to the 22-yard line. Got about 3, under 2 minutes to go here in the first half of play.
This is where you like your big receiver, Hunter. If you can get a one-on-one outside, we just saw Boyd take advantage on the other side. Big play receivers on the perimeter for Tennessee.
Neal behind Worley. Boy, that's a great toss right there, complete at the 15-yard line to that tall, imposing target. Justin Hunter picked up 7.
Well, this kid can wing it. We had that radar gun on Worley in pregame as well, and he's very talented, a very gifted passer, as you see there, 51 miles an hour. Anything north of 50 as far as context here. At the Combine 2 years ago, they did some of the same kind of measurement, and the top arms at the NFL Combine were around 50, a little bit north of 50. Mr. Bray can hum it to about 55, but it doesn't matter right now. That fastball is sitting in the bullpen.
Surprisingly, if you're just joining us, the guy with 6 300-yard passing games this year for Tennessee, quarterback Tyler Bray.
It's got to be a little more
to the bench.
Right?
Yeah, sent to the bench on the previous series.
One of those that you wonder as far as preparation this week. You wonder as far as just handling situations and handling this moment. And as I said, Bray took a sack. He missed some throws. And he was high and errant at times, and 6 of 17, a long ways from his efficiency this season. But right now, a dose of humility as he's sitting there watching his backup.
1st and 10. Lane in the backfield beside Worley. They run the fly sweep. That's Howard. And the guy they call Pig, his teammates refer to him affectionately that way, folks. He needs a couple. We have an injured player down the field. That's Kenny Ladler. Ladler, one of their top defenders, leading tackler in Stone Mountain, Georgia. This is a secondary that last week really sold out against the run. Did a great job against Ole Miss. Gave up a lot of yards in the passing game, but running the football,
yep.
Ole Miss didn't have a lot of success. Quite to the contrary today, Tennessee's kind of gash them a bunch of times up front, partner.
Well, this is still a group in the front 7 that is not SEC elite, SEC worthy. This is a group, and Bob Shoup and Jessica was talking about it pre-game, that the play is not for statistics, but in the critical areas to be efficient and effective, and they've been really good on 3rd downs and in the red zone. You see Ladler with the contact. And he also is only one of two Commodores to miss any action this season. That's a big part of this group growing together. Seven juniors, four seniors. Ladler missed one game. That is it. Outside of Colt Nichter, their D tackle, that also missed a few games. This group has largely been healthy playing together. And when you get into those situations in the red zone where you've got to play as a unit and all 11 guys got to be on the same page, you've been pretty effective.
This defense amongst the best in the nation in scoring defense, ranked 16th in the FBS.
Find a way to get Patterson the ball. Get your best players. Give them the opportunities in the big moments.
Patterson is split wide to the top of your screen. Worley looks his way. Up top. Incomplete. No flag on the play. Broken up by Eric Samuels, intended for Hunter.
You can see the conversation there. Just put it in the back pylon. Just find a way there if you're Justin Worley to say, hey, man, get that ball to the back pylon. But he's not getting all those reps. He's not getting the number one opportunities all week.
Oh, boy, it hit him in the face.
Even saying that, you're right. He could still have gotten his hands up earlier, but he's expecting that ball to be out in front of him.
Third and nine. Wide open out of the backfield lane. And Lane brought down at the 10-yard line, picked up four short of the first down, fourth down coming up. In a season that sees them without a conference win, you're thinking, go for it. Maybe?
No, I'm thinking points. And if I'm Vanderbilt, I would have probably been thinking timeout 10 seconds ago, too.
Why is that?
To get yourself an extra possession. With this Tennessee defense, it's 111th in college football. Yeah, I want to give my offense an extra possession. I think I'd have called timeout because I think Derek Dooley, the attorney, knows that getting 3 points here going into halftime, critical.
Clock running down. And Derek Dooley calls timeout. And we're going to take one right along with them. Back with more after this. Right now? Fourth down and five coming up, and Michael Pilardi, the left-footed kicker, coming onto the field for the Volunteers. 7-10 on the season.
You got to get the points.
Very controversial season for the Vol Nation. Their head coach, Derek Dooley, under siege right now. Plenty of criticism to go around. A team that has underperformed this year. Field goal good. Makes it a 3-point ball game on the field goal by Pilardi. Let's take a look back with our Mitsubishi Drive recap. Some of the cogent points so far. Vanderbilt's last touchdown started with that interception by Andre Howe. And then this nice touchdown toss and a better reception by Chris Boyd. And a juggling act in the back of the end zone. And on senior night, Vanderbilt leading by three. 14 seconds to go. Did you expect a game this low scoring? And if it's this low scoring in this day and age of 40-point first halves we've seen this year in college football, who does a low scoring game favor, if it does anyone?
Without a doubt, it's going to favor Vanderbilt. They're going to want this game in college basketball terms to be played in the 60s. They did not want Tennessee to get into rhythm, to get going. James Franklin knew coming in the danger of Tyler Bray and this explosive offense. 10 games. And in 10 games, you learn what a group's identity is. And the Volunteers have been so explosive this season offensively. Yeah, this style and these style points, I think, favor the Commodores.
Pick off a short one down at the 13-yard line. Or Norman brings it out, and got 8 seconds to go. Time for maybe one play. Put a lid on this first half. Jordan Rogers, the quarterback, has gone the distance for the Commodores. Tennessee has undergone a quarterback change in the second quarter. Vanderbilt with 10 points off of two Tennessee turnovers here in the first half. The Volunteers have won 28 of the last 29 in this quote-unquote rivalry. It's been more of a homecoming game for the Volunteers, but the guys here in Nashville thinking about
turning that beat around a little bit in Music City. Welcome back to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Miller Lite. Nashville aglow at night. It's the SEC on ESPN. Another intriguing and still some 30 perplexing minutes to be played here in Nashville as Vanderbilt leads by 3 points in this, the 106th edition of this game. Mark Jones alongside Brock Heward. Jessica Mendoza down on the sidelines. Brock, an interesting first half. When you look at the prevailing storyline of the first 30 minutes, has to be the fact that Tyler Bray, a guy with 6 300-yard passing games, maybe the most prolific player on the field statistically, got benched in the second quarter.
Seventh best offense in college football, and you take the guy that's made it go, and you put him on the bench to watch the game, and as Derek Dooley said, going into halftime, nothing to do with his health. This is the fact that he was not in rhythm, that he was missing throws, and we did see that. 6-17 speaks for itself. The overthrow early, missing Hunter, and this was the big one. This is man coverage. Nearly getting your receiver killed there, missing the shot down the field. And now we'll see how Mr. Bray handles the slice of humble pie that was served to him late in that second quarter to sit there and watch the backup do his job. Derek Dooley knows it much better than you and I do. Maybe he knows how to get his junior signal caller going and get him back into rhythm, which he needs.
Vanderbilt going to kick off to start this third quarter. Tennessee will get first crack on offense. The question, I guess, coming out, will it be Bray or will it be Worley?
And I've got to imagine this is Bray.
Patterson almost found a seam on the right side there, brought down at the 26-yard line. Let's see who comes out. Tyler Bray with his hat on will get the reins of this offense, and let's see how it measured up by comparison in the first half. You'd have to say that it was in favor of Justin Worley. He was a little bit more efficient, but that one interception led directly to a touchdown by Worley. First and 10. Last year against Vandy, Bray threw 2 interceptions. Has yet to get untracked against them. Keep it on the ground with Marlon Lane. Got about 5 on the play. And Vanderbilt in the third quarter has been pretty productive, outplaying their opponents by a margin of 56-7. But they start off the period on defense here. Bray way off the mark after that quick three-step drop intended for Justin Hunter. It'll be 3rd and 5 coming up. They were pretty successful just pounding it away. I mean, keeping it on the ground.
Find a completion. This is going to be a very critical down early in this game with a quarterback that's been benched. Can he find one of his playmakers to gain a little confidence?
He's misfired on 9 of the last 12. Blitz coming. Bray gets the completion. And Hunter trying to make a play, but stopped up short of the first down. About a yard short. He got 4. It'll be 4th and 1. And on comes the punting unit led by Mike Pilardi. So the defense holds for Vandy. You mentioned it's tough to imagine an ultra-confident player like Tyler Bray going through any kind of confidence crisis, but certainly he's off his game right now. 4th down and 1, and Krause back deep. Lardy with a line drive. And a great punt. Nothing on the return. Let's go down to Jessica.
Well, Mark, I spoke with James Franklin just moments ago, and he said he told his team it's really about controlling the line of scrimmage and being more physical. He said, Jess, you're on the sidelines. You can see that these guys are much bigger than us. It really is about us being more physical. He also said about being more aggressive on offense. It comes down to field position. He said we had a couple good opportunities in the first quarter, but besides that, they're kicking it in the 5 or the 10, and that's not working for them.
All right, Jess, and a 50-yard punt. Vanderbilt first and 10 at their own 15-yard line. Max Stacy is split out in the slot. Rogers completes it to his leading receiver, Jordan Matthews. And Matthews brought down right near that first down marker.
Well, if Coach Franklin wants to get tough, and he told us yesterday that eventually he wants to turn this program into one, then when their opponents come into here, they know they're in a street fight. They're not there at the point of attack, physically strong enough yet, but he wants that attitude and that want to more than anything.
On second and one, the run at Zach Stacy has the first down, and then some. Stacy into Tennessee territory at the 47, finally brought down by McNeil.
He's a tough kid, isn't he? Knocked out of the Ole Miss game early in the first quarter a week ago, and this is Zach Stacy. This is beating that extra blocker. You see the corner there, Prentice Wagner. That's why you've given up big plays all season long. You're there. You're the contained man. You're unblocked. But unfortunately, you're undisciplined. You lose your technique, and Stacy makes you pay.
29-yard gain for the first down. Wesley Tate now in a tailback. Stacy getting a breather. That's Matthews around the end. Jordan Matthews. Touchdown, Vandy.
I think Coach Franklin liked the third quarter adjustments. What do you think?
Quite a bit. Jordan Matthews had that turbocharger kick in, and he outran that secondary of the Volunteers into the end zone. The distant relative of Jerry Rice with a nice move, 47 yards, and a gallop into the end zone. Come back.
College football in high definition is presented by Vizio.
Welcome back, everyone, to Nashville, Tennessee. Vanderbilt leading by 10, trying to break a 14-game losing streak at home at the hands of Tennessee. And Jordan Matthews doing his part just a few moments ago with his first rushing touchdown of his career.
6 seconds. That's what James Franklin asked of his kids. I think Matthews ran that 40 and a whole lot faster than 6 seconds.
Watches it go out the back of the end zone. Let's go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. It's a Taco Bell studio update. We start on ESPN, Kansas State and Baylor, and the number one team in the country on the ropes. Nick Florence to Terrence Williams. It is 21-7 Baylor. And on ABC, Oregon and Stanford, can the Ducks be stopped? They were shut out in the first quarter for the first time all year. Marcus Mariota to Keenan Lowe, and they're on the board. We are tied up on ABC.
All right, Wendy back here. Tyler Bray back in for his second series, and not much room there on the reception. Catch made, but big hit by Carl Bolka.
Bob Schoops, defensive unit, doing a fantastic job with their eyes tonight. We've seen the corners jump out. That's a converted safety. Now your weak side linebacker, Carl Butler, having an awareness of what a scheme is trying to do against you and then anticipating and not waiting.
Second and 14.
can feel the momentum swinging in Vandy's favor a little bit here. A little heat coming on Bray. Got it off. Incomplete. At the 45-yard line intended for Hunter. Good coverage by Trey Wilson. Wilson's the guy that is maybe their top cover corner, right? I mean, has all those pick sixes.
Four of them. That's exactly right. In his career, second all-time in the history of the SEC. Six picks, four of them back to the house. And right now, he is winning his one-on-one matchups outside.
You can hear the sellout crowd. And it's not all orange this year. His second one. Down to the four.
Mark, we saw an interception earlier with Cordarrelle Patterson down the field. You tell me whether or not you like his effort here. Not only is there miscommunication in the route, watch 83 stand and watch. That can't happen. Excuse me, 84. That can't happen. That's unacceptable.
Didn't try and run down the player Hal on the interception. First and goal.
And that forced interception could also lead Bray back to the bench.
Max Stacy in the backfield. They've had issues in the red zone this year, and in particular tonight. Rodgers on the option, keeps it. Put his hat down, and he wasn't moving the pile much. Got down to the 3-yard line. Jacques Smith weighs 244. Rodgers only 210. You know who wins that one.
This is gut check time for Tennessee defensively. I showed you there the effort, unfortunately, with Patterson after the interception. But you give up seven here. With this Vanderbilt crew and this crowd that's believing they're going to get it done, you better rise up here, volunteer defense, and find a way to force another field goal. And if I'm Vanderbilt right now, I'm finding 87. Either 87 or 80. My receivers outside have already shown their ability to make plays for you.
Direct snap here. Wildcat. The jump pass. Touchdown. Tate got it. Kentrell made the catch. Trickery by Vanderbilt.
And that head coach can feel it. 30 years, 1982, the last time Vanderbilt beat Tennessee in this place. And he knows right now it is all Commodores.
The extra point good, and the lead swelling to 17 points. That's how many points Vandy's gotten on three Tennessee turnovers. Franklin all smiles. When we come back, the mantra of this Vandy team, anchor down, we'll explain on the other side of the break.
ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by the 2013 Mitsubishi Outlander Sport and Dr. Pepper 10. 10 bold calories, 23 flavors.
Anchor down has quickly become the battle cry of the Commodores, letting opponents know we will never back down from a fight. In 2011, Franklin had a display case built in the locker room where the anchor hangs year-round. And each home game, two players carry the anchor from the locker room to the stadium during the Star Walk. Welcome to my university.
All right, and you saw the anchor earlier today, and this team has anchored down. And the three fingers on each hand, the three digits, 6 seconds, six hard seconds at a time. That's the effort that he wants from his team on each and every play.
And right now it's been the one hand, the three turnovers that have turned into 17 points, the difference in this one tonight.
I tell you what, he's giving him seven.
In a group that only got eight, Mark, eight takeaways in the first 10 games, three critical ones tonight.
Patterson tried to cut it upfield and is brought down at the 18-yard line. Let's go back to the touchdown and that nice jump pass by Tate.
When you get stuffed like Vanderbilt had earlier in the game, you got to show a little creativity. And your redshirt freshman tight end, Kintera, does a nice job of selling. And how about the touch pass from Wesley Tate saying, big brother Golden, you threw one a week ago. And Golden here watching his little brother tonight, watching him hook up with Kintera and finally getting that big touchdown so necessary in the red zone.
Hey, Tyler Gray has thrown two interceptions in his last six passes. He comes back out on this series. And they hand it off to the tailback Lane. He doesn't have anywhere to go. Let's go back to Wendy.
Mark, thank you very much. And we go back to Baylor and Kansas State. The route, perhaps, is on Glasgow Martin. On ESPN, made it 28-7, but Kansas State has just scored 28-13, tail end of the first half. On ABC, Stanford and Oregon tied up. Notre Dame, also undefeated, has already won today.
All right, Wendy, and another loss on the play as Garnham brought down Marlon Lane behind the line of scrimmage. They were coming in with a little blitz, a loss of four.
And I love it. No let up in Bob Shoup. He knows the position he's got Derek Dooley in right now, got him on the ropes, and instead of just starting to play prevent, instead of sitting back, Bob Shoup's sticking to his identity, which is downhill and aggressive.
Listen to this crowd. Gray underneath and short of the first down. The Commodore defense. Staunch one more time. And the punting unit coming on for the Volunteers. The momentum has really swung in favor of the Commodores. And the last win against Tennessee at home, got to go all the way back to 1982.
And I believe that fellow was their left tackle.
And we were listening to the Thriller album still by Michael Jackson at that time, I think. Cassette. We're 8.5 to go.
Gandhi won the Academy Award.
Oh, they're gonna fake it. Incomplete. And Vanderbilt takes over deep in Tennessee territory on downs. Pilardi with the incomplete pass on the fake call. That is a monument to a major league gamble.
Desperation.
Not even close. Tyler Drummer, the intended receiver, and the Vandy superfan saying, no way, not tonight. Rogers, incomplete, just out of the reach of Quintero. Second down and 10. You like the fact they took a shot
I love it on both sides, Mark, absolutely. You've got to continue to be aggressive. There's no let up. And that's exactly the way that James Franklin is building the program here. No longer settling for being little brother. No longer settling for being the punching bag. You're going to be the aggressor at all times.
Zach Stacy in the ball game. The tailback beside Jordan Rogers. Four receiver formation. Rogers with plenty of time. His man. Touchdown! Wow, what a leap by Boyd! Actually, they're going to say that it was just shy and a flag down. Looked like he got in.
Now, he was clearly in, Mark. I think the call could be pass interference one way or the other here.
Oh, it's going to come back. The penalty is against Vanderbilt. What a tremendous effort by Chris Boyd.
Block in the back on the offense. Number 7. That's a 10-yard penalty. It will be second down.
Josh Brady, the perpetrator. And Boyd. Well, he came off, and now he's coming back on.
And you love the effort. You love your buddy coming out to help. But there, yeah, that's clearly, as you see Grady just flash into your screen there, the block in the back, and I don't even know if he needed to do it. Hard to criticize, and Franklin's never going to criticize his guys giving all-out effort there.
Second down, three. Casey on the toss, looking to throw. He's thrown touchdowns before. Oh, incomplete. It was back to the quarterback, Rodgers, and he had him. James Franklin pulling out all the stops here in the red zone. Actually, that was catchable.
Watch the quarterback sneak out after the pitch. Once again, I love the call. This is a defense that has struggled to play sound football on the back end in their technique, and it's a long throw all the way across the field.
Oh, it was
but
right
that's
there.
One that Rodgers can find a way to bring in, too.
That's why he's a quarterback, not a wide receiver. Throws it. Picked off the deflection. And Tennessee dodging a bullet. Quintero couldn't squeeze it, and Moore could. Volunteers hold. On consecutive plays, Tennessee could have, should have had touchdowns, and then this. Quintero should have had 6 points. That's the fifth pick of the year for Moore.
Can't throw it any better. Could have caught it better the play before. You can't put it in a better spot.
That's one that Vanderbilt will look at late in the game if this one gets close. Tyler Bray still in at quarterback. Pressure coming. And nobody home. He threw it away. And he is really misfiring and maybe even misinterpreting a lot of his reads.
Tyler Bray's pass is incomplete.
And he took a hit too, Brock.
Well, you love the fact you're trying to get the ball now down the field. Oh, that's completely legal. Bray's been harassed all evening long. Anytime they're backed up, it's advantage Vanderbilt.
Bray, 6 of his last 18. That's Neal on the run, and Neal out to the 27-yard line. It'll be third down. About 4 to go. The momentum in Vanderbilt's favor. We saw the statistic earlier, how much they're outscoring their opponents in the third period. And that trend continuing tonight. 3rd and 3 for the Vols. Gray. Patterson threw his arms incomplete. Let's go downstairs to Jessica.
Mark, Tyler Bray on the sideline just before this series just looks so lost. I mean, he's very solemn. A lot of his teammates coming up trying to talk to him, give him support. Pat's on the back, but you guys, at the end of the day, he doesn't look frustrated. He doesn't look mad. He doesn't even look like he's trying to fight. It really just looks like he's lost on the sideline.
You know, it's interesting, Jessica and Brock. He's a guy that usually is very effusive, especially he walks with his chest out most times, and I mean that in a positive way, but doesn't seem to have much of that swag tonight. Pilardi's line drive punt at the 32 to Kraus. And Kraus brought down at the 43. A 41-yard punt, 9 on the return. Commodores trying to close in on one and break history and make history. 17-point advantage for Vanderbilt, trying to break a losing streak of 14 straight against Tennessee, going back to 82 at home. This game could have been on ice several times. Block in the back prevented a touchdown. And then the interception by Tennessee off the pass that should have been caught by Quintero.
But this is where this group has been different. And it's exactly what James Franklin preaches all the time. The next play, and how do you handle adversity? Well, the defense rose up, and they've rose up this entire third quarter. Now it's the offense's turn to put those plays a long ways away.
This is Kimbrough, and Kimbrough got a couple. Let's go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you. A check on the number 1 and 2 teams. First, Kansas State and Baylor on ESPN. Colin Klein to Chris Harper made it 28-14. Kansas State is 6, kicked a field goal, 28-17 at the half. And the trailing minute of the first half for Oregon and Stanford, and Marcus Mariota is picked off. This game on ABC, almost a year to the day since Oregon's been held to 7 points at the half.
Wow, Wendy, you don't see that happen often. 17-point lead for the Commodores. A little receiver screen here. Pass complete out to midfield to Matthews. Got about four. You know, we saw Brian Kimbrough make that play just a moment ago. That's a guy that is a talented freshman. And really an example of some of the athletes that they're starting to get right now at Vanderbilt. There he is coming off the field. It was interesting in that he was on his way to Tennessee for a recruiting visit, stopped at Vanderbilt to use the bathroom. This is Tate, his backup. And to finish the story off, Kimbrough and a friend were on their way to Tennessee to visit their campus and their football coaches, stopped at Vanderbilt, visited here, and ended up liking it so much and was so impressed, he decided to commit to the Commodores. There's a catchy punchline in there involving like the bathroom side. I can't find it. James Franklin has closed the deal on a bunch of talented players in the last couple of years. Here's Tate. And Tate got about three. Well, coach coverage of Monday Night Football continues on ESPN. First at 6:30, it's Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's. Then at 8:30, two division leaders square off in a defensive battle. Urlacher and Patrick Willis, Bears 49ers. Good one. Monday Night Football.
That'll be physical.
Second and seven. Rodgers set up the screen. They run the screens well tonight. And a big blow delivered by Tate. And he won the battle for the first down. At the 30-yard line, got nine. They started the game with a screen pass for a big 70-yard gain for the opening score. And a nice one there for the first down.
13-10 game at half. We showed the statistic earlier, 56-7 on this win streak in the third quarter. Give Franklin and his staff an immense amount of credit. They're continuing to be aggressive. They're not slowing down. And those adjustments at halftime to continue to blitz, to continue to spread the field, advantageous for the Commodores.
Kimbrough in the backfield. I'm going to blow this one dead.
False start. Offense, number 53, 5-yard penalty, first down.
You know, during this winning streak of Vanderbilt, albeit the infraction against the offensive line here, the penalty, the O-line really has been a big key to their success. They played extremely well during this four-game win streak coming in tonight.
And in my humble opinion, that'll be the difference of whether or not Franklin can take this thing to the next level in this conference.
First and 15. Rodgers under duress. No flag on the play intended for the fullback, Fitz Lassing. Back to your point about him building through the offensive line.
Well, as I chatted with him yesterday, and we saw them earlier this year against Georgia, and really their only blowout of the season. And to me, what he's doing here has already been done. It was done on the other coast by Jim Harbaugh at Stanford, and changing the culture and becoming physically tougher and becoming and being able to win at the line of scrimmage. Even tougher duty in the SEC for him. But he knows in a street fight, which is what he wants to turn this into, you better have your biggest, baddest boys up front winning those fights.
This is a line of scrimmage league, as they like to refer to it. Another screen. Zach Stacy on the loose. The Deuce hurting some feelings here, especially those of the Vols. Pushed out of bounds at the 21-yard line. A 13-yard gain and a first down.
Yeah, these screens have been effective even against a three-man rush because Tennessee struggles to tackle. That's why they've given up explosive play after explosive play all season long. That's two missed tackles. They lose contain. They lose focus. I love the call. Right. Get your strength against their weakness in space.
Actually, third and short coming up.
And be a little wildcat again.
Direct snap to Zach Stacy here. Looking for a seam, and he got one. Earning the first down that time.
Can you imagine what this starts to feel like? These kids know. Okay, Brian Kimbrough may have stopped for a bathroom break, but the majority of these guys under James Franklin have really known nothing but failure and being defeated by this team in orange especially.
Coach Franklin's going to need more bathrooms around campus for prospects pretty soon. This keeps up.
Well, he's got a bunch of them tonight. He's got 9 four-star kids committed in right now what is ranked a top 15 class in America.
Under 3 minutes to go in the third. And a timeout called. And we're going to take one right along with them. Vandy with two remaining. Back after this. Seventeen-point Commodore lead with 2:54 to go in the third quarter. And Mark Jones along with Brock Heward and Jessica Mendoza down to the sidelines. Commodores have broken this game open a little bit here in the third period. That has been the trend for them this season. As Vanderbilt tries to establish a new sense of who they are, not only in the SEC, but especially against their rivals 190 miles down the highway from here to the east. First and 10. Choi split wide to the top of your screen.
Watch this matchup.
And now Tennessee will take a timeout.
First timeout of the half, Tennessee. That's a 30-second timeout.
Well, Tennessee down 17. And Brock, when you think about the climate that this Volunteer team players program has been under, 0-6 in the SEC this year, it has been a long time since they've been winless in the conference. Derek Dooley's job has been up for speculation and been talked about, rumors. What is it that they do right now to get a sense of where they, I mean, the rudder right now, where is it on the field?
I think you're seeing it. I think you're seeing desperate times calling for some real desperate measures. I thought that benching of Tyler Bray in the first half, it didn't smell right at the time. And to me, it smells of desperation. And you're 4-18 in the SEC. And Derek Dooley and these fans, they know it. You have an AD that did not hire this head coach, this fan base that will not settle for this whatsoever. 4-19 against the SEC now if this continues to play out in the three seasons. And with the resources spent, the history, the tradition, Derek Dooley knows it. You could get the sense in talking to him this week. He knows what he's up against. And this was a game he could not afford to lose.
On the blitz, empty formation, the pass complete. Matthews, touchdown Commodores. But there's a flag down on the play.
And they're going to call a hold on a pancake block that I want to take another look at. Tremendous effort once again by Vanderbilt down the field. Receivers, linemen.
That is Jake Bernstein.
Holding on the offense, number 53. That's a 10-yard penalty. Repeat, first down.
I said to you earlier when Josh Grady was running down the field, you love the effort. And once again, the big fella, you loved Bernstein down the field, but that's an easy call. And that's an obvious call. That's a physical error, though. That's not a mental bust. That's an effort. That's a want to. That's a help my buddy out down the field to do what I can. The redshirt freshman's just got to learn in those moments. Can't grab, reach, and hold. You're going to get called.
Back to the 17. Max Stacy split to the bottom of your screen. Into the end zone. Boyd, incomplete. No flag on the play downstairs to Jessica Mendoza.
Well, talking to Derek Dooley, guys, even leading up to this game, he talked about the mentality and the negativity around this team even coming into it. He said this team doesn't know they're going to win. They're hoping that they can win. He said he really needs a win just to tip them psychologically in that positive direction. He even mentioned, you guys, Vandy's on the opposite end of this. They're on a win streak. They're exactly where we need to be.
Vanderbilt looking for an opportunity here, Jessica, to really get more separation. Caught, and they're going to rule complete right inside or at the 10-yard line to Jordan Matthews. Gain of 7. Great footwork He got that foot in, that left foot.
James Franklin's getting his guys ready for the NFL. We saw Boyd earlier on the tremendous play with the body control. Getting both feet in. Matthews does the same. This is a well-coached group, isn't it?
Yeah, Matthews.
We've seen a lot of football this season on both sides in all phases. James Franklin's coaching these kids up.
Direct snap to Zach Stacy here. Little Wildcat action. Cuts it back up. Touchdown. No flags. Zach Stacy's seventh rushing touchdown of the season, the 27th of his career, the senior playing his last home game here.
Breaking the will of your opponent. At the line of scrimmage we saw earlier tonight, a real issue and a real challenge for the Commodores to get movement, to win at the point of attack. Watch your offensive line, watch the double teams, watch the physical contact and the want to and the will overwhelm these volunteers.
You know, James Franklin talked to us about the culture of what's happening now, and you can see a lot of faces there that have bought in.
What's he saying to them?
Let's keep playing. Let's keep going. He's erased a lot of the negative perceptions of Vanderbilt. He was telling us that, hey, you know, a lot of these guys that he's recruiting now, they don't know about the bad past, the bad history here. What they're seeing are the Sports Center highlights of Vanderbilt winning games.
Those smiles say it all. There is still a lot of game to be played, and you're exactly right. That's what the head coach is reminding his players. But deep down, he knows that he can be saying it and verbalizing it and trying to communicate and make sure they get it. But deep down, he knows he can't be more proud watching his team physically impose their will against their arch rivals that have owned them over the last three decades.
And in a very controversial video that went viral last year, the celebration inside the Tennessee locker room, probably using that as fuel as well. Here's Patterson, stopped on a dime and made a great cut and got rocked at the 29-yard line. He got stuck by Kerry Spear. That's the kicker.
He was feeling it.
He's not used to it either. He's a little woozy. Hey, you know you're balling out when your kicker is going down and making hits on maybe their best player.
Oh, I shouldn't be laughing. That's nothing funny about a head injury, but that's a 5'10", 185-pound kicker going up against one of the elite kickoff returners in all of college football. It's 6'3 and 205, and he just put the smack down.
A 190-pound kicker. Well, while we have a moment, folks, let's take a look at our FaceTime profile brought to you by Edward Jones. Andrew East, a civil engineering major. Very accomplished player, both on the field and in the community.
And a long snapper. And I bet he's got some concern for his buddy over there who set the school record, single season field goals. Kerry Spear was 17 on the season. And if that does not epitomize want to and buy-in from everybody in your program, you can hear the
chant. They're chanting his name. Good to see him up. It's that Rod Tidwell moment from Jerry Maguire almost.
Franklin asking him where he's at.
And Patterson, in a good show of sportsmanship, giving him a little pat on the helmet, and you see a smile creeping across his face now.
I have a feeling that that will make a Vanderbilt highlight reel somewhere. I just have a sense.
They'll have that on rewind on the clicker a lot, won't
even
they?
Maybe even a recruiting pitch. Even our kickers anchor down.
A 24-point lead and a disconsolate-looking, confused-looking, disconcerted-looking quarterback, Tyler Bray, who has not even come close to being on point or on his game tonight. They hand it off. For a great bounce by Lane, and still on the move. Tried to drag him down by his towel and his shirt, and instead he's all the way into Vandy territory. A 31-yard gain, maybe more yards than they've gained all quarter.
That doubles up the output. Just 13 yards, four drives of nothingness to begin this second half. And this is about gut check and will and want to for Tennessee as well.
Ray rolls out. Patterson couldn't turn around in time. And this offense is as disjointed as it's been all season. And keep in mind, only 10 points on the board. Folks, this is an offense that averages 37 a game.
Mr. Patterson is not giving his quarterbacks any help tonight. As electric and dynamic as he is, the previous drive, third down pass, one-on-one, put it up, couldn't make the play. That time, just sticking one hand out instead of two. Receivers are not winning these challenges on the perimeter. They've done it all season long, not tonight.
And off to Neal. Neal got about six on the play.
Obvious four down territory from here on out for Tennessee.
With as much as Bray has struggled here in the third quarter, is there a chance that maybe Worley comes back in the next period? Or is it all Bray from here on anything? You live and die with the guy that got you here?
I think you tried to make a statement to him while this game was competitive that you better get on point. And unfortunately, that didn't work.
Here's Neal. Oakland tackle brought down at the 33. That's short. Well, the first down, under a minute to go now in the third period. May making the stop. Once again, the third quarter belongs to the Commodores.
Once again, everything that Jess was talking about, that Derek Dooley reiterated this week about belief and finding ways to win in 1-3 and one possession games. Remember, this was a Tennessee team that was a fourth down away from beating Missouri a week ago, and right now not responding to all the adversity.
They run it on 4th and 2, and I'm not sure they got it. Looks like it's short. Lane brought down by Marshall. And depending on the spot.
Yeah, he's going to be short.
Yeah, that line is just an approximation, keep in mind, but he is way short of it. That's Vanderbilt football. They're not even going to measure. Commodores win again on defense.
Your leading tackler for Vanderbilt. The two safeties are tied. 65 apiece coming in, and they finish their tackles. Going to see him come from the secondary level.
And folks, something that you haven't seen here in a long time. Folks in orange, a procession to the exits. A litany of fans beginning to leave. With the 34-10 scoreboard showing, 11 seconds to go in the third period. The ball's down and Tennessee fans heading for the bus. Who would have thought? These have been different times for the Volunteer Nation. Sweep into the boundary, that's Kimbrough. As time winds down here, the player's shaken up. It's number 34, Lathers.
I think as his helmet popped off, he took a shot maybe to the face.
Vanderbilt breaking this game open in the third quarter. Right now in the middle of a 21-0 run. And the seat got a little bit hotter for head coach Derek Dooley.
And this is going to be very difficult to overcome. The lack of a bowl game a season ago. Higher expectations this season, no doubt about it. And on a night, where their defense gave you opportunities in that first half, the defense played much better in the first 30 minutes than they had throughout this season. The offense couldn't get going. He benches the quarterback. And now in the second half, it's been all Vanderbilt, and that defense that has been exposed throughout the course of this season, once again, getting taken advantage of.
Three quarters in the books. Vanderbilt on the brink of something big here when we come back. Okay. City of Nashville aglow at night. And a story tonight outside of Darius Rucker coming to town soon is the Vanderbilt Commodores making their own kind of music. As we start the fourth period, they lead by 24. A huge burst of offense in the third quarter. And the statistics really show the story. Look at them out gaining Tennessee almost 3-1 yardage wise.
Started to wear that front seven of Tennessee down at the line of scrimmage, hit their shots down the field, played tremendous defense, continues to blitz and harass and take one of the more electric offenses in college football through 10 games completely out of their game.
Zach Stacy taking the direct snap. The Wildcat running it between the tackles. Now, does Vanderbilt play conservatively here, or is it too early to go into conservative mode?
Well, I think you play smart. That was a conservative call to answer your question. It's going to take about 40 seconds off the clock. But you can't go in a shell either, and I don't expect their defense, I really don't, to just play zone and give up completions after completions. That's not in their DNA and their makeup. I will say, Tyler Bray had the look to me over there as a quarterback that's done for the night. Well, he actually put his helmet back on. I stand corrected.
Hopefully for Vol fans, he's not done in another sense. Boy, what a punt. Patterson calling for the fair catch all the way back at his own 10-yard line. A 50-yard punt, nothing on the return. Bray going to try and get it going. Well, tensions are at their peak as Brad Keselowski tries to hold out five-time champ Jimmy Johnson in the final race of the season to determine the championship and earn a spot in history. The NASCAR Chase for the Sprint Cup, Ford EcoBoost 400 at Homestead, Miami, Sunday at 1:30 on ESPN. And Jeff Gordon got into a little dust-up last week, fined $100,000 and docked 25 points. As Bray completes the pass to Rivera. Let's go back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you very much. If you're a fan of chaos in the BCS, you may be in good shape. Here's Colin Klein, intercepted for the second time tonight by Sam Hall this time. And on the ensuing possession by Baylor, they take advantage of the opportunity. Glasgow Martin, his second touchdown, 34-17 Baylor, 35-17 Baylor on ESPN.
All right, thanks a lot, Wendy. Brave. Completes that pass. Fumbled out of bounds. Are they saying it's complete? Looks like they're saying it's a catch and then fumbled out of bounds. They're going to spot it at the 38. Justin Hunter was working against Trey Wilson. Hunter making the catch right there. Oh, yeah. Well, he did have it. Looked like he took a step with it.
I think he did. They may take another look at this one, but I think he did have possession. Two steps, and then the ball comes out.
Is Neal. Neal across the 40 to the 42-yard line. You know what, partner? This last 12 minutes and 40 seconds, what is it going to say about the team and how much they're playing for their coach at this point?
Oh, I think it's going to say everything in their effort and their want to. There's no doubt about it.
We're going to see if this volunteer team plays to the final whistle.
False start, offense, number 70, 5-yard penalty, first down.
Remember, coming into tonight, two wins of the last two games. They have Kentucky next week. Theoretically, they go to a bowl game with their six wins. But a loss tonight, and it's a second consecutive year without postseason play for it. Neal in the backfield beside Tyler Bray. Bray behind his receiver, incomplete. Man, it is looking disjointed tonight. As Bray taps his chest and says, my bad. Last three games, his completion percentage, 65%. Tonight, 39.
I give an immense amount of credit to Bob Shoup and James Franklin and their plan coming in to blitz relentlessly, to not allow him to get into rhythm. But you've also got to wonder about that benching in the first half as well.
Third and nine. Bray zips it, and his receiver got drilled but hung on to it. And a flag thrown as Dallas made the catch. Picked up 16.
And there's actually going to be two flags here on the field. One with either the defense lining up in the neutral zone or an illegal formation by Tennessee, followed by that helmet-to-helmet contact.
There are fouls against both teams. Illegal formation, number 70, was not in the line of scrimmage. Personal foul targeting, number one on the defense. Those penalties offset, replay, third down.
Going to do it over again.
It's going to be Kenny Ladler in the back. The safety coming in. And I don't know about that call. A point of emphasis, the targeting, he doesn't even hit the helmet. He's hitting the shoulder pad. The shoulder pad, the shoulder pad.
Third and nine. Bray, by the way, had a little zip on that pass. Stepped up and sacked back at the 31. They got to him. Kyle Walsman back to Wendy in the studio.
Mark, thank you. Just a reminder, second half now underway. Stanford and Oregon on ABC, and it's still tied up 7-7, 7:38 to play in the third quarter. Oregon on the move.
All right, Wendy.
Oregon a fourth quarter team, Vanderbilt a second half team. You asked me on that play, will this team show up? Will they finish? Mark, that was a three-man rush against a group that had given up five sacks the entire season.
Already cuts off a rocket of a punt back to the 18. And good coverage by the punt team. A 51-yard punt, four on the return. And this Tennessee team looking very dispirited in stark contrast to the levity on the sidelines for the Commodores. It's the SEC on ESPN. And perhaps a changing of the guard between the Tennessee teams.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by Miller Lite. Grab your friends, bring your IDs. If you're 21 or over, it's Miller time.
Nashville, Tennessee, a look at the Country Music Hall of Fame. I've taken a couple of tours through there. Great place. Some exhibits with my favorite country star, Toby Keith. And of course, I got his latest track, you know, called I Like Girls Who Drink Beer. One of my favorites.
You are multifaceted, aren't you?
Chameleon-esque.
NASCAR a week ago. Country music tonight. I love it.
First and 10. Commodores with the ball. On the run, Zach Stacy stomped up by Corey Miller. Approaching 11 minutes to go, Tennessee winless in the SEC.
This is your friend right here. There's a line you want because Vanderbilt, like a lot of college offenses, are tempo and rhythm. But this is time as a quarterback you start to maximize that play clock.
Commodores, meanwhile, looking for their seventh win of the season. Stacy looked like he had problems hanging on to it initially, but got through the hole. He's going to set up a third down, maybe about three to go. Zach Stacy, one of 19 seniors playing their final home game here. And this is a senior class that has more than contributed to turning around the trend here at Vanderbilt with the new head coach, second-year head coach, James Franklin. On the receiver screen, Matthews makes the catch and has got some turf in front of him. How about that? Touchdown Commodores.
Commodore.
are changing times in Nashville for college football.
When was the last time you saw a Vanderbilt receiver on two occasions run away from Tennessee? Not just Matthews, the Commodores running away from the Volunteers.
Coach James Franklin more than excited right now. With good reason, his team leading by 31 points. He's over the moon right now, or at least over Morse. Commodores with a commanding lead.
What did he say to us yesterday? I may be 40, but I'm old school. And some of this excitement, more than anything, is what we have been talking about throughout this night. They've worn Tennessee down. They broke their will. And it's not just been the big plays. It's linemen blocking. It's receivers downfield. It's the extra effort. It's the want-to. It's your kicker knocking out their star as well.
It's kind of symbolic the way things have gone tonight. On the return out to the 23-yard line. Let's go back to Wendy Nix in the studio.
Mark, thank you. Back to ABC, Oregon Stanford, 16 plays, 95 yards in 3 minutes and 20 seconds, capped off by DeAnthony Thomas. Oregon 14-7 over Stanford, and the Ducks are driving again after a Cardinal fumble. And Nick Florence backed up, throws an interception at the 1-yard line. Kansas State would score on the ensuing possession, 35-24 on ESPN.
Rorty in the ballgame now.
False start. Offense, number 85, 5-yard penalty, first down.
That's a tight end, Brendan Downs. Tyler Brace probably done for the night. Derek Dooley in his third year as head coach. You know, there are players on this team that have seen the coaching change and seen players upset with the change, and they run it. That's Neal for a couple of yards. It's a lot goes on with when a new coach, people understand, you know, some members in the media, it's kind of an inanimate change, but to the players in a program, when there's a new coach, there's a lot of upheaval there.
In recruiting and in donations and your booster, I mean, all of it. You want that needle pointing in the right direction, and Derek Dooley knows this. He's a big boy. He knows very clearly the results aren't good enough.
Worthy on the screen to Neal. Chopped down at the 24-yard line. Yeah, I remember Tennessee players telling me that, you know, when Philip Fulmer was fired, there were guys in the locker room crying. It's a very emotional time for a team when these kind of things happen. And you know, there's been a lot of speculation, and these youngsters aren't immune to some of the chatter, the static that goes on outside of the program.
And I'll say this, it's going to be very difficult for Derek Dooley. You know, I hate to sit here and to speculate, but in reading and talking and listening, he knows what he's up against. And the next coach in is going to be inheriting a very senior-laden team next season.
Worthy way off the mark, behind the receiver, incomplete.
The old adage was give a coach 4 years. That's changed. That dynamic has changed in college football. With the instant success that some have had, you just typically don't get, you know, what was the norm at one time. And next year, this offense, they're playing 5 seniors. So 17 starters are going to be coming back next season, including a quarterback that was off his game tonight, but that was electric all year. For the 5 offensive linemen return. They need some help on the back end of their secondary. There is no doubt about that. But the next coach coming in here, if there is going to be a next coach, is walking into a veteran-laden volunteer team next season.
Derek Dooley certainly knows about hard work and success. He was a former walk-on at Virginia who became a 4-year starter and worked his way up the coaching ranks. But tough sledding this year for the Vol Nation and their head man. Folks, get your NFL Sunday started on ESPN at 10 a.m. Sunday NFL Countdown. Chris Berman and the crew getting you all this good stuff up until kickoff. Then, before you set your lineups, catch Fantasy Football Now at 11 a.m. on ESPN2. Our experts with the latest news to get your top fantasy performers going. That is a mullet on steroids, Brock Ewers.
I think it just gave it away. The question,
man,
yeah, it's got to be a wig.
He had us. We need another shot of that from our producer, Jim Zeroli, getting us great shots. And Jimmy Plyler, director in the truck. A 1 yard gain by Kimbrough.
Well, the key question was obviously Derek Dooley's future, but the second was, is this a wig or not?
Yes.
And I think clearly we have our answer.
They say about mullets, right? It's business in the front and party in the back. Oh, boy. That is a super-duper mullet. Well, for Vol fans, this type of season will make you lose your hair. Second and nine. Tough night for a team that came in averaging almost 37 points a game. Kimbrough on the run for the Commodores. And Tyler Bray, who had 6 300-yard passing games coming in this year,
in his struggle. In his worst day since Alabama in 2010 as a freshman, and just not on the same page. He and Cordero Patterson, this was the critical interception. But time and again this evening, and this isn't about the confusion of Vanderbilt. This is about a quarterback and a receiver that just are not connected. Disjointed, you've said a number of times this evening. And he's averaged over 400 yards passing the last three games as he's sitting next to his buddy Justin Hunter trying to figure out what went wrong tonight, what went amiss. I do give an immense amount of credit to this Commodore defense that played sound, that blitzed him, that hit him, that sacked him twice for a guy that was sacked five times all year. You can't be that different a page from your receivers from beginning to end.
Rodgers throws it away incomplete. You know, this is not by chance. When you look back to last year, they schemed pretty well against Tyler Bray in Tennessee, holding him to just 189 yards passing and two interceptions.
Mark, this is a Vanderbilt team that has schemed well all season. You're talking about the 16th best scoring defense in college football. Let me say that again, the 16th best scoring defense in college football at 18 points a game, and holding a crew that's averaged 37, just 10 tonight.
There's Patterson. Oh, the whistle didn't go. The whistle didn't go. He wasn't down. He sat down on the tackler, and that's going to be a touchdown. Patterson. He was thrown, but never hit down. He was put down on his seat, but never tackled. One more look. You'll see it, folks. Right there. Watch. His butt never touched.
That's exactly right. That's a touchdown. I think Michael Dyer did that in the championship game a few years back, didn't he?
Sure did.
The elbow does not go down. The forearm does not go down. That's a touchdown.
Darrell Patterson, 81-yard return for the touchdown on the punt. Barring a major turnaround here, Derek Dooley's team will miss out on a bowl game for the second consecutive season. They're going to go for two here. Early hands it off, and they run it in for two. That's Lane. This game was a lot more competitive, went to overtime, in fact, before Tennessee finally won on a pick six for a touchdown. But there's going to be a lot of firsts for Vanderbilt at the end of this game and moving forward at the end of the season. There's five-game win streak since 2008, seven-win season since 82. Winning streak in the SEC. They got that road winning streak as well in the SEC. As James Franklin continues to change the culture here in Nashville. Told us a great recruiting story yesterday about number 50, one of his players, offensive lineman, Jelks, Andrew Jelks, and how Jelks and his parents were longtime Tennessee fans. Mom and dad both attended school in Knoxville. Both were grads, and on the visit to the home, there's Jelks there saw the Tennessee memorabilia, posters, t-shirts, jerseys all over the walls, and Coach Franklin able to go into that living room and convince the young man Jelks that Vanderbilt was the place for him. That wasn't happening 5 years ago.
And this wasn't because he was a two-star recruit going to Vanderbilt. This was a four-star recruit out of Paris, Tennessee, that the Volunteers were desperately after as well.
Here's the onside kick. It's going to be Vanderbilt football at Tennessee's 41. We talked about the recruits here at the game tonight. An important night for the Commodores. Now that recruiting class is ranked 16th.
First class a season ago where every recruit was three stars or above. That was unprecedented. That didn't happen. You could have put that on that graphic there with all the other firsts, and this one's going to be better. Arguably the best class in the history with where this thing is going, because you think he had a story before, you think he could go into a living room and pitch the Vanderbilt way and what they're doing before, will now give him minimum 7 at Wake Forest next week, 8. Who knows, a bowl game, 9 wins. What did he say to us yesterday? It's not about renting a legacy like many programs where you can go and fit in. It's been done before. You're building it here.
Yeah, you buy it.
And I thought a pretty telling story yesterday, because this is a sales business. Recruiting is pitching your story. And when he said, hey, do you want to be that kid that 30 years from now, that 30 for 30 on ESPN about when it turned at Vanderbilt? Do you want to be a part of that? Because you have the opportunity to do so.
Coming up next, BYU taking on San Jose State. Second down and 8. And they're kicking that game at 10:41 Eastern time. Wesley Tate behind the quarterback, Jordan Rogers. And Tate, a couple of nice moves down to the 33. Let's go down to Jessica for more.
Brock, Mark, you talk about the program that Vanderbilt is building here, and Franklin told us this week it's really easy to take over a program that's at the bottom of the barrel, because these guys have been successful in everything they do, so they are going to scratch, crawl, do whatever it is. And that's, Brock, you talked earlier about that will. That's where they get it from, is because these guys do not want to fail. And he said it's easy when you get into a program similar to whoever's getting Tennessee next year that's at the bottom of the barrel.
The point to us that it's easier to get guys to buy in when they bottomed out.
And it's easier to get buy-in, Mark, most importantly, when you have success on the field.
Third down and 2. Rogers keeps it and will pick up the first down and get down safely at the 24-yard line.
All the study halls and the academics are rigorous here. All the winter drills, the early morning meetings, the weights, the lifting in the summer, these games in a very physical conference, all of that. And you got to have some success. The payoff has got to be victory. To put in all that work and all that fight and all that want to, he knows it. And he's been at places with success. He was with Ralph Friedgen, where they had a lot of success at Maryland. He's been at Kansas State, saw what Bill Snyder did and built there. And as I said, to me, this line of scrimmage will be the most critical area to get from a 6-7 win, because through scheduling and everything else and some of the pieces he has, he can get to 6 or 7 wins.
Well, that's a line of scrimmage lead as they run it again. That's Tate straight ahead inside the 20 to the 18-yard line as the clock continues to run and is the ally now with the Vanderbilt Commodores.
Because you look at this season and what they have accomplished, there's still Georgia, there's still Florida, there's still the big boys in this division, in this conference, that they're going to have to go through to get to the standards that he wants to, and to do so is going to be, instead of 275 on your offensive line, 295 and 305 and physical difference makers.
Got a player down in the field. That's the center. Actually, no, it's the tackle, Joe Townsend.
Yeah, they're all interchangeable. You can say center, guard, yeah, tackle,
around,
because
yeah,
they do. They all play multiple positions.
Let's go back to the studio and Wendy.
Mark, thank you. Cody Hoffman, 3 touchdowns last week. Hoffman and BYU making its first trip to San Jose since 1968. This game will kick off at 10:41 Eastern. It will start on ESPN News until you're all finished up in Nashville. At that point, it will switch over to ESPN2.
All right, thanks a lot, Wendy.
Townsend, one of those bigger boys. He's a sophomore. He's just under 300 pounds. And they're going to have to develop them and build them. They are going to get some of the Andrew Jelks we showed earlier, 6'6", 275-pound freshman. But even Andrew, he's redshirting this year. He's the guy that's got to develop, and they really like him. Those four stars that he earned through the recruiting process, they feel are very real, and they look forward to him putting on 15 or 20 and being some of those difference makers at the line of scrimmage that they're going to need moving forward.
You hear the fans chanting here. This was a sellout crowd. And James Franklin did his share to make sure that it was mostly Vanderbilt colors and not that Tennessee orange. He instructed some people at the ticket office not to sell to tent fans from Knoxville. I'm not sure how you do that, but that was the instruction. Tate brought down at the 11. Jessica, what can you tell us more on that?
Well, Mark, what's crazy is James Franklin, not only he wanted more Vandy fans, but he wanted the Vandy students who leave for Thanksgiving break to stay. So we actually went to the dining halls, to the student union, started asking students who's staying, who's going. He actually got on the phone with parents and convinced them to let their kids stay an extra day watch this game.
You know what that is, partner? That's like politics. You got to have a good ground game. And football.
That's right.
Got to have the good ground game. That's what we learned.
It's getting up at 5 a.m. and leaving at 11 p.m. It's a big part of what he's doing and what he's building. And for him, what a 30-point victory over Tennessee. But
here's Tate again. Nice spin move. And stopped up shy of the 15-yard line with about 2.5 minutes to go. Vanderbilt is looking at its 7th win of the season against 4 losses and improving now to 5-3 in the conference. And what a night for 19 seniors playing their final game. Guys like Zach Stacy, Jordan Rogers. You know, we didn't mention throughout the course of the evening that Rogers is actually the first junior college quarterback they've had at this school. And he really recovered well from stumbling earlier this season. Had 4 turnovers in this game last year against Tennessee, and been very efficient tonight. Tate couldn't get outside, brought down behind the line of scrimmage at the 13.
Now, this was a Vanderbilt team, Mark, that was sitting at 2-4 and had a real decision to make. And in fact, we were in Athens, Georgia, when they got spanked 48-3. And I can remember vividly saying to you on the air, you know, it's one thing to build your program and have a lot of close contests and see if you can take that next step. But they got humiliated there in Georgia. And instead of sinking, instead of laying around in their in misery and pity, they said, no. We're a different Vanderbilt. This has got to be a different season for us. And now reeling off 5 victories in a row with the opportunity to go to Wake Forest next week. And believe it or not,
legal
get
substitution
to 8 wins.
On the offense, 5-yard penalty, 3rd down.
Penalty against them. And, you know, head coach James Franklin was 10 years old the last time that Vanderbilt defeated Tennessee. That puts things in perspective. Still had his Snoopy lunchbox.
He is still fired up with 68 seconds to go.
Jordan Rogers, I mentioned, he bounced back. He was benched for the Presbyterian game. And his brother Aaron Rogers was actually in the stands. Had to watch him sit the whole game in the win that they got, albeit. He came back in the subsequent game and has held on to the starting position ever since. Under a minute to play, and this one, folks, is cooked, glazed, and about to be sliced, but not before another whistle. Commodores call a timeout.
This Wednesday on CSS, it's a Mississippi State football replay as Arkansas visits the Bulldogs. Arkansas, Mississippi State, right here, Wednesday at 10 p.m. Eastern on CSS.
Nobody does what Papa John's does.
Get a large double bacon 6-cheese pizza topped with hickory smoked bacon and julienne cut Canadian bacon. Try one today, only $11. Or for just $1 more, choose any large pizza, even specialties.
victory formation. Third down and 17.
Rodgers takes a knee. And that's going to do it. Derek Dooley's team still winless in the SEC. James Franklin. An uprising here in Nashville. An insurrection. A changing. It's a new day for the Commodores as they snap that insidious losing streak at home against Tennessee. It comes to an end at 14. Tyler Bray struggled tonight.
This was no fluke. This was a beatdown.
Final score, 41-18. Vanderbilt never trailed. For the crew, I'm Mark Jones. Good night from Nashville.